Good afternoon, everybody. I think we'll just start. My name is Fergal Cahill, and I am the incoming chair of the Structures and Construction Division. So just want to welcome you all here today. It's great to see so many people here. This is kind of a trial. This is the second half-day seminar that we've run. And what we were finding was that it's hard to get people to come to evening lectures. So what we're trying to do now is kind of package up three or four lectures together and kind of run them as a half day. And it's worth 4 hours CPD. So whatever company you work for, if they're running a CPD program, it should be encouraged. Like, and just tell all your colleagues that we'll be doing this twice a year. So we're always looking for feedback. And if you've got any comments on this format, or if you'd like to see anything else down here in Engineers Ireland, I'm just going to give you a spiel about structures and construction for about 2 minutes, and then I'll hand over to our first speaker. But just in terms of the Structures and Construction Division, for those of you who don't know, we're one of 32 groups in Engineers Ireland. I didn't even realise there was that many groups in Engineers Ireland, so I looked it up yesterday. There's 12 regional branches, there's 11 divisions and 9 societies. So we're just one of those 32 groups, and we're all kind of vying for people to take part. I have a few stats in the next slide, but just in terms of the committee, there's 18 of us in the committee. I'm the chair, and Emmett Davis from Irish Rail is the vice chair and secretary. And we come from all different backgrounds, students, public bodies, consultants and contractors, and we're always looking for people to get involved. So if you feel like you have a calling and you want to get involved, just drop myself or Emmett an email, and you know, we'd be glad to have some new blood on the committee. Or if you want to see anything being run down here, we're trying to get the whole thing more vibrant. So if you have any ideas, just we'd love to hear from you. And I suppose the main idea is to provide you with a professional network to, I suppose, broaden your knowledge base through continuing professional development. So that would be events like this, or it could be like site visits, or it could be courses. So just a few stats. There's 3,500 of us that's affiliated ourselves with the Structures and Construction. So just, I think there's 23,000 members of Engineers Ireland. So we're about 15%. And most of us, I suppose, are either studying or working with structures or in contracting or construction. In terms of our age profile, there's about 80, we're pretty young, there's about 80 of us that are less, 80% of us that are less than 45 years of age. So for some reason it kind of drops off a cliff in the second half of people's careers. So the last 20 years they don't seem to get involved here. So we're either not relevant to them, or they're too busy, or I'm not sure. But if there's anyone that's in that particular, you know, between 45 and 75, I'd love to hear what they would like to see down here so that we could try and get that that profile up a little bit. In terms of membership grade, there's about 50% of us that are chartered and about 35% of us that are ordinary members. So we would encourage anyone that's thinking about getting chartered, that there's no point in putting it off. You may as well just do it. And anything that we could do to help you along that path, we'd be delighted to do so. It is a milestone in your career, so it's worth doing if you're not chartered. In terms of where we are, there's about 30% of us in Dublin and 70% outside Dublin, so we're fairly well dispersed. Definitely Dublin-centric, but there's still 70% of us around the country. This is where we're terrible. We have 10% female membership, so there's a complete gender imbalance there, and that's something that we would like to obviously work on, and something that we've set ourselves a goal for the next 12 months or 24 months is try and boost that a little bit. But at the end of the day, it's up to yourselves. Like, you get out of it what you put into it, I suppose. And if there's anything that you'd like to see being run down here, or if we can do things better, just drop us an email or talk to us afterwards. So just getting onto today, we've got three great lectures for you. Each one's going to be about an hour long. We'll have questions and answers after each session. We'll stop at about 4:30 for coffee, and then we should be done dusted by 6:00. So I'm just going to hand over to Emmett Davis now. He's going to introduce Marcus, who's going to talk about the design and construction of the River Erne Bridge.
So just with lecture one, the design and construction of the River Erne Bridge by Marcus Sanchez. Marcus is Associate Director at ARP, and he's their Acting Europe Bridges and Civil Structure Skills Leader. I suppose a brief introduction for Marcus is that many of you probably know him already. He's a bridge and structural engineer with extensive experience of over 20 years in detailed design and design management of medium to long span bridges. Marcus has worked on many prestigious projects throughout all stages, from planning, conceptual design to detail design, and offering head support from the office during construction. Marcus's experience covers many types of structural systems and construction methods, such as balanced cantilevers, arches, cable stayed structures, and also many different materials: reinforced pre-stressed concrete, post-tension concrete, steel concrete, composite bridges, etc. Along with these skills, Marcus has significant experience in project management and of large infrastructure projects and multidisciplinary teams. I suppose the specialties would be major bridge design, concrete and steel bridges, deep foundations design, management of major infrastructure projects, steel composite bridges and cable stayed bridges. And so, Marcus, thanks very much.
Okay, well, first of all, I would like to clarify, my name is Marcus, not Juan Jose. And I'm not Juan Jose's brother. It's a very common surname in Spain, although Juan Jose is actually a very good friend of mine. I work in Arup, and Arup was not involved whatsoever in this bridge. So I'm just doing this because Juanjo, which is a good friend of mine, had to cancel the trip in the last minute. And he handed me last night 75 slides. So if I actually make a couple of mistakes, another bridge for modern reasons, but just I will hope you. He sends his apologies. He was actually very apologetic about not being able to make it. Okay, what do I need to do to go to the... So I'm actually doing this presentation on behalf of Juan José Sánchez, who's one of the senior bridge engineers in Ferrovial. I must say I work in that company for 12 years as designer, like Juan José, which there are many links. But I will reiterate, I was not involved personally in the detailed design of this bridge. I'm going to do a small introduction now. This is exactly what the presentation is going to be. I'm going to show a bit what Ferrovial Design Office does, because it's a bit strange for conventional type of contractors in Ireland, because it's actually a construction company. But they do detail design in-house quite a lot. And then I will explain a bit what is the concept behind the Stratos Bridge and what actually is relevant to the Erne Bridge. And then I will detail the key elements in the Erne Bridge, including the design constraints that were coming from the specimen design at tender and the geometry and the construction and the rest of the elements as it was detailed through the different stages in detail design and construction. Ferrovial in-house design office designs a lot of bridges for Ferrovial. This is actually a very good example because in particular both Juanjo and myself were the lead designers in this bridge in the early 90s, between 2001 and 2002. And this bridge is actually 250 meters span, was designed fully in-house by Ferrovial. And the challenge was not only the span, but also the construction in a tiny island. It's one of the smallest islands of the Canaries, which require very tailored construction methodology for the whole erection of the bridge. And Juan José and I were actually, at the time I was working in Ferrovial, were the two lead designers in this bridge. Juan José himself has done many other longest sound bridges. This is around 100 meters, also in the Canary Islands, extremely slender structure, both designed and built by Ferrovial. Another key element, which is actually probably the area where Ferrovial excels the most, is they do a lot of segmental bridges. Spain is a good country for segmental bridges because you have a lot of valleys to cross with mid-span range. This is actually 60 to, probably those are 95 to 120 meters. Ferrovial does some of them, and they refine the whole segmental construction. You can see the one in the top right, in the bottom right, which is actually even with props, which is casted in two stages. It's actually probably the most refined type of segmental bridge you can have. And they actually own their own launching gantries, and they basically deliver the whole system. In my days in Ferrovial, we were designing usually three or four segmental bridges at the same time in different parts of Spain or the world. And for you that actually haven't seen a segmental bridge in 4 minutes, you can see the type of construction. It's actually, it takes a bit more than 4 minutes, but far less than you can imagine. It actually, you can put around 6 segments a day, three on each side of a cantilever. This bridge is actually 110 meter main span, which is the longest that Ferrovial does at the moment with launching trusses. And they do everything. They own the launching gantries, and they deliver the full detail design, erection engineering, everything from the in-house design office along with the construction team on site. This bridge is again in the Canary Islands, which again requires a very specific arrangement of the whole construction methodology due to working in a small island. Okay. Also, it takes a bit longer than these 4 minutes, because it's obviously fast motion. But I can tell you that that direction of the whole deck that you can see there, it's a bit more than a month. At the moment, as far as I know, Ferrovial owns 5 launching countries like that one. And now after the publicity, we're going to start with what we're supposed to be talking about. That's Ferrovial's part. I'm going to talk about the Stratos bridges, okay? First, what's the origin of the Stratos bridges? Well, this is the first kind of conceptual design done by a French engineer, Charles Matibat, in the 80s. About a Stratos bridge. It was trying to come with an innovative idea. Looks like a cable stay bridge in terms you can actually see exposed cables. But the tower is actually very shallow. In fact, in this particular case, this is actually the cross section of the sketch we used. The tower is only 8 meters high for a span that was over 100 meters. You can see the deck also that is actually pretty stiff. It's actually 3.7 meters. That in 100 meters, again, is about 1 in 30. I think it's 120, the original idea. It's not actually as the span to day ratio is not as large as you would have in balanced cantilevers, but it's definitely not a cable state bridge. So it's a kind of hybrid. This bridge was never built, okay? There are precedents of this type of bridge, which is basically having the post-tensioning coming out of the deck in a solid fin like this one. This is from the 70s, from Christian Men. You cannot call it per se a Stratos bridge in terms of the post-tensioning system is conventional, even though it's outside the deck. But the real first Stratos bridge as such, having actually very shallow towers and the towers and the cables playing a different role with the deck, you can see it even has haunches in this. I don't know if you will see that. Yeah, it has a haunch here. So basically it's a hybrid between a conventional balanced cantilever and a cable stayed bridge. This bridge is Arawara by Kashuga, which is kind of the pioneer, and he has more Stratos bridges than, as far as I know, than any other designer. In Japan, they're very popular. I'll say there are around 20 or 30 Stratos bridges. And that's more or less the concept, which in general words means it's basically a hybrid between a cable stayed bridge and a balanced cantilever concrete deck. Okay. To me, probably the Zenit of Stratos bridges is this one, extremely slender, 1 in 200 in the deck, and 6 towers in Switzerland by Christian Men, built in 2003, with a very special arrangement because the bridge is curved in plan. It's the only way to achieve that slenderness. But it's, I mean, the aesthetics of Stratos bridges and the functionality is obviously something open to debate. Okay, and this is the longest span at the moment, as far as I know, which is 200 and something like 30 meters, something like that in Japan. Another feature of Stratos bridges is that you can do multi-tower, because you don't have the same issues you have in conventional cable stayed bridges, since the deck is actually stiff enough. And I'm going to explain a bit what it doesn't mean, this concept of being hybrid. I mean, it's very easy to define it, but then we come to putting numbers and defining how Stratos bridges behave is slightly more complicated, okay? Basically, we all know, let's start from the beginning, the main parameters of a pre-stress bridge, a post-tension like balanced cantilever, as you've seen Ferrovial has done a lot of them, and many other people, that's a very common bridges to basically span the range of 60 to 150 meters. You have a span to the ratio that goes 1 in 20 to 1 in 40, 40 in mid-span when you have a variable deck software. The cables are stressed to 75% of the breaking load, more or less, and the change in the stress of the cables and their SLS is tiny. It's 30 newton per square millimeter or less. So the cables will actually increase their stress from 0.75 of the ultimate stress to 0.85. That's a conventional pre-stress bridge. On the other hand, you have a cable stayed bridge, which is a different structural system. You can see those red arrows there, basically elastic beam, which is a system that under the live load, part of the load will be in the deck and part of the load will be in the cables. It's a far more slender deck. You can achieve 1 in 200. The cables are stressed at a much lower load, usually 0.3 to of the ultimate load, because the stress range under live load, the Q load, is around 200 newton per square millimeter, and that creates fatigue issues in anchors and in some of the elements of the cable. So basically, the maximum stress is usually around 0.45 of PU. Okay. So when you go to an extrados bridge, which is a hybrid, as a hybrid, the first part is easy. You say, okay, and I'm going to go to 1 in 200, and I'm going to have 1 in 20, and I'm going to be something in between. So I can have a span today radius of 1 in 45, 1 in 60. But the next thing is, what is the stress in the cables under permanent loads? You interpolate the codes, you will see in a minute what the code says. What is actually the stress range that I will allow under live load? And what is actually the maximum stress I will allow in SLS? So those things are not that clear. Well, the first one is very easy to interpolate, which is pure geometry. When you come to the rest, you need obviously to be backed up by codes and state of the art, and isn't that simple, okay? One of the, before we go, and I'll explain later on how you actually play with those parameters, that's actually the key of a stratus bridge. We have certain unknowns in what do you do with the cables and how you stress them. But on top of that, when you look at there's another element which is very important, and in the Erne was very important, which is, okay, we know the geometry already, the towers are shorter, the cables are shallower, the deck is stiffer. But then you have another issue, which is the connection between the saddle and the pylon. Because the tower is very short, the tower tend to be very stiff. And what happens is that when you have an unbalanced force between the cables, in a normal cable state bridge, what happens is that the tower has bending. In a stratus bridge, because the tower is so short, when the force becomes unbalanced between the cable, what happens is that the tower takes the load, which means basically that you create a differential load between both sides of the cable, and because you have a very small area, again, you're not going to have a double anchor system in general, because you will need a very wide tower, and you don't need it because the tower is small enough. You end up having saddles. So you have an issue in general, depending on your type of bridge, that the cable will try to slide on the saddle. And the conditions of sliding is another element, along with the previous ones I mentioned, that actually are important. Now, the deck connection is important in this element, okay? So when you have actually an issue in relation to unbalanced force, how the tower and the deck are connected is very important, okay? And in general, you have actually two type of stratus bridges. Those in which the pylon is connected to the deck, and then there is a bearing under, which is not the case of the Erne, but there are many other stratus bridges with that configuration, and I'll show you a couple of them now and another one at the very end. And then you have other type of bridges where the deck passes through the pylon, and basically the pylon is independent, which is the case on the Erne bridge. In both cases, sliding on the saddle is critical, but it's critical for completely different load cases. In one case, it's created by the non-symmetrical pattern of the live load, and that affects the longest cables, because it's when the pylon moves forward along with the deck due to the rotations at the supports. And I'm not going to cover these guys now, but I will do in a couple of years. Okay, I will explain that later on. And then you have, which is the case of the Erne, a completely different problem that again affects to the sliding of the cables, which is basically due to, and this is the peculiarity of this bridge, of the Erne bridge, of the independence of the tower and the deck, because they are not connected with each other, and what happens with the horizontal displacements on the permanent loads in this case. Okay, this is an example, actually done by Ferrovial as well, in Poland, built by Ferrovial, but designed by Polish designers in this particular case, where you can see that the bearing is under the tower, where the leg is, but the deck and the tower are completely connected. So the behavior of this bridge is completely different than the Erne. When you load one of the main spans, the rotation of the deck will push the tower forward, and basically, against the common sense, the longest cable in the main span that is loaded will reduce its load, because the pylon is moving forward in a rotation which is basically given by the deck, not by the pylon itself. So the cables that are actually closer to the midspan will reduce its loads, and the cables at the back will increase its load, basically making the cable sliding backwards. Okay, that's the main feature of the stratus bridges in terms of the saddle design. But this is not the case of the Erne. The Erne is a bridge like this, where you have a bearing coming from the other side, and the pylon is basically going through. There is a feature there that the deck comes in and out, but the deck and the pylon are not connected. And we will explain later on what is actually the peculiarity of this stratus system, okay? So those are basically the main issues that you need to take into account in stratus bridges: stress ranges for the cables, and what happens with the saddle in the and the concept and what actually values you use is not that simple, and we will see it in a minute. Okay. So what happens with the stress bridge and the structural codes? The first part is simple. It's conceptual design. You have less stiffness, shallow cables, and so on. So how do you actually combine that with codes? So then when you go to the codes, you find this. This is the Eurocode, the official code to be used at the moment in every country. What the Eurocode says, if you this is actually in 1993, part 11. If you do a search word of the word stratos, the answer is zero. This is the requirement for a cable state bridge. So what the Eurocode says about stratos bridges? Nothing. So you either make it as a cable state bridge, or you cannot. You have no other code within the current standard, but it doesn't say that you should do it. It doesn't say, there is not even a sentence saying stratos bridges should be designed as cable state bridges. It's simply ignored, okay? So it's something that you will say will lay in a gray area of the code. If you go to other standards, which are probably they're not applicable as per the law, but they're actually state of the art and recognized worldwide as the key standards. If you go to the FIB bulletin number 30, it says something very interesting. The official version, which is the one you have at the top, says exactly the same thing of the Eurocode, okay? Which is 0.5 of the ultimate guaranteed stress with bending, and 0.45 if you don't have into account. But if you look at the draft, which some of us have when you're involved in these commissions, it says something different. At the end of, when they were actually finalizing the document in 2003, 2005, something happened, because it had the stratos bridge there, and it starts saying something about if the range of stresses, there's some kind of interpolation, as you can see there. The 200 and stress range and the 0.45, as you can see in the first row, is the conventional cable state bridge. The sternal tendons, which is basically a system that is not bonded pre-stress in a box, it's external internal bonded, allows you to go to 0.75, which is conventional post-tensioning. And they had a line there covering some kind of interpolation. That was actually in the FIB Bulletin 30 draft. But the last version, the top one, is the one that everybody knows. That one was removed. And all we have now in Bulletin 30, which is a worldwide known document for testing and for the design of stays, is the same thing you have in cable state bridges. So that's not a good source. If you go to the PTI version 6 of 2007 had nothing. 2012 had this curve. This is actually very difficult to convert because it's an American unit. The Americans use the whole system inverted. They basically have five factors that are not or gammas. So it's difficult to actually play. But basically these 2 points, this 0.75 of the breaking force equates to 0.6 goods, more or less, because it's for a different load case. And the other, the 0.65 equates to our 0.45. You have to believe me in this one. Believe me, I don't know the numbers, and that's what it is. And basically, the 2 points you have there for the frequent load case basically are the same 46 newton per square millimeter, which is a small range of variations in your cable, and 180, which is when you start actually considering when you have a range of more than that, you go flat into the 0.45. So the Americans use an interpolation curve, which is linear, for this. The French are the only ones that in their own cable state code, prior to the Eurocodes, had a particular case. If you can speak French, you can read it. This is actually for stratos bridges, you have it there. You can see the word, in fact, the word stratos is French. For the cable state bridges, stratos bridges, they allow you for an interpolation which is coming with that formula there. Depending on what is the range of your stresses under the frequent load combination, you're allowed to apply this formula, which basically made for 140 the 0.45 goods, and for 40, 0.6. Okay, and beyond those 2 points, you should actually stay outside the curve. When you draw that curve, it's a bit like that. And this is in the Iarnród bridge, for example. So the Iarnród, and we will explain that later on, it's a bit of a spoiler. You have the dots there in the Iarnród bridge. They go slightly over the red line. The red line is, we ignore the stratos bridges. They don't exist, so 0.45. And the blue line is the curve of the French. So basically, the Iarnród bridge is stressed slightly higher than the 0.45 goods, because the stresses you have are very low, are around 90, 80. Okay, you can see them there. So it is within a range that you might say is non-compliant with the standard, but the standard does basically is to ignore stratos bridges. Okay, and I will explain that a bit later on in more detail. So then it comes to ULS. ULS is even worse because not even the French, basically they say that Stratus bridges should be like a conventional staying cable stay bridges, which runs into other problems in terms of you cannot actually take so much advantage of going to 0.6. The Eurocross keeps saying nothing and the PTI says nothing. So at the moment, the whole thing with the Stratus bridges is an area where it's quite difficult to know what you have to do with your cable. Okay. Sorry, I'm going backwards, forward. Okay. Then is the second part, which is sliding and slipping over cables. You have this formula that, again, is a complicated one because how you apply this in ULS is not that simple. And the gammas you have to use for your sliding and the friction coefficients and the tests done by the different suppliers makes this a bit difficult. And I will explain this later on in detail, particularly because of the load cases you're considering. Okay, and now let's try to apply all of this on what really happened in the Erne Bridge. I have highlighted which are the key elements of Stratus bridges, and at the moment different people in different parts of the world, because the standards allow them to apply. The Americans are probably the easiest ones because they have PTI at the moment acknowledges the Stratus as a special type of bridge. Now I'm going to detail a bit more what happened in the Erne and how the Erne Bridge was designed. Okay, first is the design constraints. The Erne Bridge, that's, if you have driven the entry to Donegal, you will actually cross through a bit from Belturbert. It's a 142 meter long bridge with two side spans of 36 and a main span of 70, more or less. The specimen design was fixed. There were many things that couldn't be changed. This was a design and build tender that Ferrovial won as contractor, and the in-house team, Juan José Sanchez, was the main designer in the bridge. First, the deck is extremely slender. It's actually in the high end of the Stratus bridges. It's particularly slender. It's not actually this hybrid. The deck is constant depth, which makes it difficult and tricky at supports, and we'll see it later on. Second, the lateral spans are a bit short, okay? And the cables are particularly shallow. In general, Stratus bridges have shallow cables, but these are very, very shallow, are 12 degrees, and you will see it in a minute. Another issue is the slenderness of the deck. I mean, in cross-section, the maximum depth is 1.5. But that's a bit of a fake depth, because in reality, in a conventional box, you will have a wide bottom flange, which is the typical efficient section under bending for concrete PC boxes. This is not a conventional PC box. The form was fixed, and it's a very inefficient shape. In reality, if you calculate the conventional second moment of area versus your area, and you compare it of which one you will have with a box, which is what I'm saying there. I mean, if you do the span to the rate, it is 1.52 at the only point that where you have actually maximum depth. For 69 meters span, that gives you 1.46. You will say, well, not too bad. Well, in reality, that's because the shape is actually very inefficient. You don't have a wide bottom flange. If you do this equivalent rate here, I'm telling you, this deck is 1.60. So it's a very, very shallow deck in reality, because it's a section that is architecturally pleasant, but engineering inefficient. Okay, you don't get the best area to second moment of area ratio. I'm just going the wrong way, sorry. And this is the bridge as it was when the Ferrovial started. And it has two other challenges. First was the first Stratus bridge ever in this country. And for Ferrovial at the time, was the first Stratus bridge they were designing, which this added, obviously, additional complications. Everybody was in the learning curve in this bridge. Okay, there were some other environmental constraints that, to be honest, in my opinion, having been in Ireland for 12 years now, were probably the least I've ever seen, because they were allowed to basically take over certain peninsulas in the river, and that facilitated the construction of the bridge within certain actually time periods, obviously for salmon and other environmental issues. But in general, they were allowed actually to go into the river. I mean, the Erne is not a particularly large river in this location. That's why the span is only 70 meters. Okay. And I will explain this later on, because actually it has a lot of influence in the way the bridge was built. Then there's another major issue, which is actually because the span is so short. This is relatively, I mean, it's probably the shortest Stratus bridge you can do. The pylon is only 8 meters high, so basically the shortest cable is very short. So the tolerances, when you apply the tolerances in terms of angles and forces in cables, the cables are so short that it's extremely difficult to achieve because of the size of the bridge. So that actually posted additional, in general, the tolerances you have in angles in conventional cable stay bridges are much larger because the cables are very long. You don't have cables like this when the shortest cable in this bridge is around 10 meters long. So it's a very, very short cable. So if you have a small angle tolerance at the deck, you will have a massive local bending in the cable. So that required a particularly challenging construction tolerances when they were built. Okay. Now, actually, summarizing a bit what the bridge geometry is, we know the spans. The spans are actually going to go through, this is actually a description of the bridge. It's pretty graphical. They have a lot of videos done. As we were saying, it's actually near a 70-meter span. The abundance are actually very much hidden in terms of the bearings. This is actually, obviously, a non-integral structure, given the length and the structural configuration. But the abundance and the gallery is all actually hidden. So basically, it looks as close as possible in terms of appearance as might look to an integral bridge, even though there is actually a bearing gallery there. The north abutment, the abutments are relatively simple. They're basically, when you can actually reach limestone close enough, it's basically an open abutment like this one. This is actually a cross section of the abutment. You can see the gallery there. And they actually need to dig around 7 meters in the north abutment. And the south abutment, unlike the north one, sorry, there's another video here. Because the rock was slightly deeper, they ended up doing piles. So it's one abutment is piled and the other one it isn't, and it's just because the limestone was slightly deeper in one side and in the other one. So I mean, and basically both abutments have this architectural shape trying to hide the bearing shelf. The columns already are very architectural, and they were fixed. They were not possible to change it. As you can imagine, the contractor tried to make much simpler columns. Okay, but it was not actually possible. You can see there the first cable is only 2 meters over the deck level. As I was saying, it's a very, very short cable. Okay, that's the geometry of the cable, and this is a bit the... this gives you an idea of the complexity of such a short column that is 10 meters over the deck and 8 meters under. They have different like sections that you have. Every single section is different than the previous one. Is tapering in all directions all the time. So they basically, the steel work of the column was particularly complicated. You can see here how the section varies as you go through the whole length. And they are relatively slender for the inefficiency of the, because there is an angular effect in the cable. The cables are actually not in the same plane of the column, which basically, they're heavily reinforced. This is the deck, as we've seen before. It's basically a post-tension slab. So on top of this, the cable system, you have also a longitudinal post-tension. You can see the cables here. Okay, some of the cables were passing through, others were actually anchored at midspan, and I will explain why later on. There's a good reason why they're actually different. As I'm saying, it's a pretty slender deck, particularly when you take into account the cross-section shape. The post-tensioning has, as I'm saying, two different types of cables. You have actually the other cables are anchored here, which is the one you saw before, while the central cables are actually passing through. This is a typical cable. You cannot actually go lower because there is no section, basically. And that's the reason why most of the cables are completely flat on the outside. It's a very inefficient post-tensioning system. While the central cables are the only ones that you can actually apply the conventional profile in a box, basically taking the maximum height at hogging and the minimum at sagging at midspan. Okay, and this is basically the cross-section. You can see here clearly why you need to anchor some of the cables, because they won't be efficient any other ways. You need to achieve maximum prestige. These cables cannot have lever arm. This is actually supports and this is midspan, but this one, there is very little room to move the cable around. Okay, and this is, I think it's, you can see the cross section here. This is another model that Ferrovial did before starting the project. I mean, obviously it's a very small bridge in terms of overall size. And you can see here, which was the dimension of the deck and how the cross section works. Again, you have a lot of webs. It's not particularly efficient just to, for a slender deck, concrete. I'm sure the quantities are at the very end. Okay, the tower again is a very short tower, as I'm saying. The first cable is only 2.3 meters over the deck level. And the cables are actually separated like 1.5 meters. And the 12 degrees is a relatively shallow angle for a Stratos bridge. Okay. All the cables have a saddle. Once you have actually a small pylon like this one, saddle is the best option to basically hide everything within the pylon. There are 50 strands in each of the cables, and you can see the saddle there and the connection to the deck. And there was actually a fatigue test done. You can see here the fatigue test done in the cables following the FIB recommendations. And you test the saddle with a reduced number of cables, Because if you do for the full number of cables, you will need a far bigger. In some cases, there is not even a press big enough in the planet to run 2 million cycles in a fully loaded saddle. Okay, the main cables, as I'm saying, the anchors were also tested, and I will leave it there, because there's a lot of histories behind the testing in these cables. Okay, and that's the installation of one of the cables on site. Another construction sequence, well, videos are usually the best for the construction sequence. This is a video done by Ferrovial at the very early stages. There's very little secrets in this bridge instead of a construction sequence, particularly because of the possibility of having a small peninsula in the river. So it was basically built as two half cantilevers over a scaffold with a central column in the center, as you can see. So basically, one deck was poured, half a span, in the first the north side and then the south side, and you place the depth tensioning and then the main cables. You can leave that little island there with a central prop, and then you build the other side exactly the same way. By basically, they did it in two different seasons because the constraints were time, but they were allowed basically to reduce the river width temporarily and build the deck in two different sections. So in reality, compared to other type of bridges or other stratus bridges, the construction sequence of this bridge was particularly simple. Okay, the complexities were in other elements of the design. Okay, so it doesn't have actually a lot of history or tricks like this bridge in terms of construction. This is a few stages, like real pictures of the construction. This is basically the excavation of the abutments. This is the abutment that was actually with a spread footing, as I was saying. This is the building of one of the two peninsulas. This is actually you can see the aerial view and the reinforcement at the bottom of the first part of the north part of the bridge. This is the post tensioning from the abutment of this first section. And this is the installation, as you saw earlier on, of the first pair of cables. Then the second was actually done, as the previous case showed, symmetrically. And then just the whole thing was removed. The cables were stretched to the final stage, and the finishes were actually placed. So it's not a particularly complex construction sequence. Okay, some design considerations, I mentioned them already. Now we're going to actually repeat them and how they apply to this particular bridge. As I said, the red line is what the Eurocode says, or the FIB bulletin says, if you ignore the existence of stratus bridges, which is a constant 0.45 goods if you don't take into account bending your cables. The blue line is what the French code says, and this bridge is slightly over the red. Okay, and this requires obviously certain discussions with the authority in terms of, and it's all related to, we are really far from the 200 Newton. Okay. The crossing point, according to the French code, is 140, which is that point over there, which was what Appendix 21-8 of the contract indicated that you should comply with. So basically, the cables were stressed slightly over the 0.45 goods. They didn't push it to the limit, because in fairness, it wasn't necessary at all. Okay. Then we come to the issue of the slipping of the cables on the saddles. And this is a problem that this type of bridges have when you have a passing through deck, and in particular, when the bridge is very small, as this one is. The problem of this bridge, from a critical design point of view, is that the short cable is very short. So in reality, what I mean is slipping is because obviously the deck is completely independent in horizontal movements from the pylon. So basically, as all you can imagine, in a bridge like this three span, the neutral point, both under permanent loads and the temporary effects of creep and shrinkage and temperature, is more or less the center of the bridge. So what happens is that as you go close to the abutment, you have larger movements, both in the thermal and in your long-term shortening of the bridge due to creep. What happens then is that those movements are completely independent from the cable itself and from the pylon that is not connected, because you have a pod which is sliding in a longitudinal direction. So what happens is that when the pylon, the deck is actually shortening, the four stays are stressed higher, just due to this effect, and the back stays, because the deck is moving forward, is losing load, so they're in compression. So this imbalance in the horizontal direction in a very high pylon in a conventional cable stay bridge will produce bending and movements in the pylon. But the pylon is so short and so stiff that in reality the pylon takes the load, which basically means that the load keeps imbalance in the cables, which basically means that the only way the load can take that is by friction. So this becomes a critical load case for the saddle. And then it's when it comes how do you actually do that using the formula of Eurocode. Because if you apply this in ULS, it's nearly impossible to make it work. But then you start questioning, is actually ULS as a ultimate law case something that you need to consider for laws that are nearly quasi-permanent? And which coefficients do you need to use both to reduce this gamma here, your friction, and basically which is this ratio between the unbalanced forces on each side of a cable. Okay? So in cable stay bridges, as I say, is usually fine. In stratus bridges is the governing case. Okay? What happens in SLS, which is what really matters, is ULS is for structures collapsing, and avoiding structures to collapse. And you should question whether in ULS you should allow your cable to slide or not, because it doesn't actually jeopardize the behavior of the structure. Okay? SLS is a different thing because it's serviceability and that affects the durability of the structure. Okay? What happens in this bridge is that in the short term, the bridge actually works and it's very easy to make it work. In the long term, when the bridge keeps shortening due to creep, it becomes very difficult to make it work, particularly in the Erne Bridge because it's very short, the shortest cables. Okay? So what happens is that because in reality you're going to weight those cables in the total lifespan of the cables in 25. So basically the cable failed to slide in the 120 years when you apply the creep and shrinkage. But by then, you have already replaced the cables and you will probably weight them at some point in the future. So what this bridge has is actually a compromise on which at some point in the future you will unbalance, you will remove the unbalance in the loads due to the shortening and creep and shrinkage under SLS load case long term. So the cable technically slices slightly with the uncertainties of creep and shrinkage and temperatures under the SLS load very long term when you apply the minimum temperature combined with the and in ULS slippage is allowed because that's basically if ULS happens, if this bridge is subjected to a very abnormal load, you can go back again with a jack and rebalance the loads in the cables. It won't be actually a massive issue anyways. Okay, and again, this is done because in reality, it's impossible to make it comply. You want to comply with non-sliding in the cable for a ULS case. And the standard is not very clear in what you have to do. Okay, there are some pictures of the complete structure. I mean, it's a relatively modest span, I must say, it's 70 meters. And as you can see, the deck looks extremely slender. Okay. Here you can see basically that what I'm saying, the shorter cable is slightly higher than the parapet itself. So it's, you can see that it's actually a pretty small pylon in general. Okay. And actually, this bridge won the Irish Concrete Society Awards in 2013. Yeah. Built in 2013. And a summary of the main parameters of the bridge. Main span is 70 meters. The side spans are very similar to the main span. The span to the ratio is technically 1 in 45. As I say, I will challenge that is more closer to 1 in 60. And the pylon dimension, the pylon height to span ratio is 1 in 7, which obviously makes it a stratos. It's not actually the conventional cable stayed bridge. There are 50 strands on each cable, and the angle is actually 12 degrees. It's pretty shallow. Okay, the span, the concrete quantities is basically 0.7 equivalent depth, like 0.7 cubic meters per square meter. That's actually pretty heavy for such a slender structure, and it's because you have a lot of webs. But then when you go to the post-tensioning, and that shows how inefficient this structure is, just the post-tensioning of this bridge in a conventional structure, those 45 kilograms per cubic meter means that you can make it work without if you don't have the constraints of slenderness, you can make it work with that amount of post-tensioning as a PC box for that span. So because you still have a lot of post-tensioning required, because the cables, as I showed earlier on, the post-tensioning is very efficient. Most of the cables are basically flat. Okay? So it's a very inefficient structure in many other ways. And again, the reinforcement ratio of 300 kilograms is horrendous. It's very, very high. So in reality, this structure works, but it's actually pushed just to the limits of inefficiency in many ways. Okay? And finally, I want to mention here, this is actually, in this one I'm involved, by the way, what I'm going to show now. This is the first stratus bridge built in Ireland, the Erne Bridge. I'm just going to wrap up now. But there's another one in the construction that hopefully in a few years' time we'll have a couple of lectures about it. Okay, which is in New Ross. It's slightly bigger, and that's going to put actually, I'm going to put the two of them together now. This is the Erne Bridge, as we've shown, it's a 60 meter span, and the river barrel one, which is currently under construction, is that. I can promise you, I haven't faked the scales. But that shows you the difference, that of scale. That one is going to be world record in concrete. And it's currently, the design is happening as we speak. Arup is actually doing the little design along with a Spanish consultant, Carlos Fernandez Casado. And it's currently in the early days of construction. Okay, and that will be a challenge. I'll say in a few years' time we'll have a few lectures about this. Again, you can have them here in perspective, the two bridges to compare the scale. It'll give you, it's not, I'll say that that's a small Stradivarius bridge, but that one is big. That will be a big bridge. Okay, and that's it. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Marcus. That was a great presentation. I'm just going to have a short questions and answers session now, if I can get this to work. And just we're recording this session, so if you do have a question, could you just put your hand up and just say who you are and ask the question into the microphone, please?
Before you ask any questions, obviously, if they're extremely specific of the project here in Bridge, I might not be able to answer because, as I said, I wasn't involved. Ferrovial Design Office was, and Juan José Sanchez. If there are more general about the start of bridges, like obviously I will give you my opinion. I'm involved in the design of several of them.
Anyone got a question? I'll just start off with an easy one. Just in general, in terms of the costs of bridges like that per square meter, like how much of a factor above RD over a conventional bridge? Would you have any idea? And the second part of that is, like, in terms of their maintenance, are they a lot more expensive to maintain versus like just a beam and slab bridge over its 120 years design life?
My,
I don't want to put you on the spot now.
I know. I'm going to answer honestly to the two of you. In my experience, the reason why Stratos bridges are being built is not financial. They're not the cheapest option in any circumstances, to my experience. There is always some type of aesthetics or like other type of reason. If you don't want to have a massive box, if you're these days you can do, and they're actually built 230, 250 meter balance cantilevers. They look horrendous because the section that supports have 12 meters depth. If you want to avoid that, and you want to avoid a conventional cable stay bridge with a very high mast, it's a good solution in terms of actually a compromise.
Yeah.
But they're more expensive than both. Mm-hmm. A cable stay bridge is cheaper in general, in my opinion,
yeah,
when you go to the an efficient section and for longer spans, and a stratus bridges and a conventional balance cantilever is also cheaper. So when you do it, it's because you have another requirement based on avoiding a massive section. So it's a compromise.
Okay.
So I would say it's around 10-20% more. It depends on many other circumstances. But I would say that it's likely more expensive than a cable stay bridge and significantly more expensive than a box.
Okay.
Okay. In the second part, my personal answer, I don't know, because as far as I know, the whole technology of saddles and the maintenance of saddles, all the saddles at the moment, and all the different providers, like the top firms in the world, BSL, Fresenet, and a few others, have designed like their own bespoke systems. They're sold as replaceable strand by strand and so on, but in so far, there is very little experience in replacing a strand in a real bridge. So the technology is there. It tends to be a good system that you can replace your cable and you don't have actually a double anchor in your tower. But in so far, there is no information in historic cases, precisely because it's a brand new technology. So
yeah.
My honest answer is I don't know.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. All right. Anyone else a question for Marcus? An easy one? Yes, we won't. Okay. Great.
Just what might be the attraction of these types of bridges in terms of construction and design over other types of bridges, or is there any?
For this type of bridge?
Yeah, for this type of bridge, what might be the appeal to a designer or a contractor?
In my opinion, it's mostly coming from the client, this an extrusiveness. If you look at the bridge in the Erne, it could be perfectly a three-span steel bridge, but then we'll be deeper at support. So if you want to have a certain clearance, you will need to raise the road. And if you want to do a conventional cable stay bridge, which in that case probably won't actually be that necessary, you will have a high, so you are actually breaking the landscape. So to me, it's more visual and a client requirement of having a structure that is a compromise in terms of actually visual permeability than a real requirement from a purely financial point of view or ranging a particular span. Because it's something that is hybrid. If you have a very long span, you do a cable stay bridge. If you have a shorter span, you will actually do a balanced cantilever or concrete or in steel composite in different ways. You know, a conventional beam bridge, you know. So it is in between, and it's usually, in my opinion, is related more to aesthetics and to a the client wanted a bridge that is a compromise in terms of actually a slender deck and not a high mast.
Thanks. Great, I think we had one more, yep, great.
Hello, my name is Martin. I'm working for ARP, design engineer. I have a question concerning the flat post tensioning cables you mentioned. I didn't get the whole idea. Like, why did you put in the middle a standard form of the post tensioning cables and then outside the straight ones? Could you please explain it one more time?
What happens is that you need to achieve as higher compression as you can in this deck, particularly at mid-span. If you have the inefficient cables, which are the top one, and the upper ones, or in your cross-section, the one in the both sides of the deck, so in order to maximize the compression force at mid-span, certain cables were running all the way, and other cables were actually anchored at mid-span. Okay, so they're actually stressed from both sides, while the central cables that you see there are running all the way. So only those cables that are running from the whole length are anchored. You will see them crossing through here. So you have a double anchor system here, passive anchors for the other cables, and these ones are running for the full length. And these ones, the other ones are basically shown here. You can see the anchor as well. They're really flat. They might look high to you, but in reality they're actually very close to the center of gravity of the section, because the section is so inefficient in cross shape. So the second moment of failure is very low, because you don't have, if you were doing this section ignoring aesthetic requirements, you probably would have a third of the deck with flat slab and then an inclined web and a cantilever. But with this current shape, to achieve full compression in this point, you have very little lever arm to put cables in, because these cables are already higher and these one are much higher. Okay. So it was, could be done either way. You can actually, but it was just certain cables were actually cut there, because it's easier already, because you have, if you start actually splicing these cables, you need to basically make a solid web here. And this area was already solid enough, so it was easier to basically anchor these cables. It's all to actually minimize friction losses and achieve as maximum compression as possible. As I said, in terms of post-tensioning, the post-tensioning ratio of this bridge per square meter of deck, with my previous experience, you can do this, obviously not with this deck, it has to be much deeper, it won't be this. The reason why you have the straddle system is because it's a very slender deck. But if you were able to change that and come up with a conventional deck soffit bearing, you can actually have the same amount of post-tensioning and no straddles. So basically, that shows what the principle of the design is. You have the cables to achieve a very slender deck. The alternative is to remove the cables and the straddle system and to basically have a variable deck soffit much deeper at supports, not actually 1.5 meters, but probably at a different cross section.
Okay, thank you.
Maybe just one more question, if there is one, and if not, we'll go on to. There you go, Simon.
Cheers. You mentioned the Japanese bridges, but you didn't mention the codes that they use there.
Yeah, well, because as far as I know, there is no code in relation to straddles bridges. From what I know, my Japanese is not good. But Akashi Kashuga has published several papers where he establishes the principles they use in Japan, in English. Those are the ones I've seen. This guy has like 10 different stratus bridges, and they use a code very similar to PTI, which is basically linear between two stress ranges. If the cable has a low stress range, you're allowed to go to 0.6, and if you are around like 140, it's very similar to the French, but instead of being a curve, it's actually a linear. But I've seen it in papers. I haven't seen it in the Japanese code as such, because as far as I know, it's only in Japanese, and it's not easy to read, though.
Okay, I actually just have one last one. Just in terms of impact on the cables, is there any information in terms of what those cables can take? Because I know the parapet is only designed to resist a car. So if they were hit by a truck, I presume.
There's a lot cage which is basically a cable off scenario, assuming that someone or something hits the cable and the cable breaks completely.
Yeah.
And in that scenario, what happens to the saddle is something that, in my opinion, the saddle fails. And whether you can use it again or not is a completely different thing. So you have a local failure, because the cable will slide completely through the... And for that case, it doesn't matter whether you have clamps or anything. There's no way, if the cable is actually broken on one side, that you would, the saddle will be able to take the friction load of only one cable. But the whole deck is designed in that scenario on which you can actually take one cable off. So in that case, obviously, the cable needs to be replaced. The anchor is already designed to be replaced. The deck will stand and will comply with the standards. And the saddle is the element that is actually not that easy to know what will happen with it. But in general, the bridge is designed to take, well, it's not that cable is designed to take the load. It's that it's not relevant because it's a fuse. You can remove it by an accidental load case.
So like, one of the disadvantages of using a saddle is then that you're losing two cables as opposed to if it was anchored.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. All right, so I think we'll just wrap it up and move on to our next lecture. I'd just like to thank Marcus very much. I can verify he did actually stand in at the last minute. The guys cancelled on Friday, and we thought we were going to lose this lecture. So Marcus stood in, and I thought you made it your own, really. So thanks very much. Appreciate that.
Thank you. Cheers.
Okay, I'm just going to introduce our next speaker and lecture. It centres around preserving historic railway viaducts. Irish Rail have developed innovative repair and strengthening techniques to retain, preserve and extend the longevity of several of its ageing metallic bridge stock. This presentation will focus on a number of rehabilitation projects that were undertaken to retain and increase the lifespan of some of its railway viaducts. The presentation will describe the original existing structures and the challenges that were overcome in their assessment, repair and rehab. Some of the projects featured have also appeared in the paper that won the John Henry Garrod King Award for the best paper within the ICE Journal. And our speaker is Aidan McAdam. He's a chartered engineer and specialist structural engineer with Irish Rail. Aidan has over experience with particular expertise in the design and repair of historic railway bridges. Aidan has worked on a number of major bridge rehab and strengthening schemes recently, including the Care Viaduct in Tipperary, which is a 86 metre long three-span structure consisting of continuous half-true box girders, the Thomastown Viaduct in Kilkenny with a main span of 67 metres consisting of a main bowstring arch girder, and the Slatty Viaduct in Cork Harbour, which is an 8-span viaduct with a cumulative span of 137 metres, consisting of bowstring arch girders and supported by cast iron columns. And then in design, construction and project management, Aidan has a wide variety of experience in relation to railway structures, and some examples will be the Dunboyne Railway Bridge, which is a single-span 31 metre long arched box girder, the Drumsna Bridge replacement, which was a 4-span 97 metre long bridge consisting of half through girding worn trusses, and then also the Malahide Bridge replacement on the Dublin to Belfast line that most of us will know about. So I'll just hand over to Aidan now.
That's great, Fergal. Thanks so much for the introduction. Yes, this afternoon I'm going to give a presentation on a number of historic rail viaducts within the Éireann Éireann Irish Rail network. I'm going to give you some details about some of the strengthening work which we've done to strengthen these viaducts and also to allow us to maintain them into the future for future use. So the presentation itself, I'm going to split it up into a couple of different sections. What I'll do firstly, I'll introduce you to the viaducts I'm going to talk about and also the location, just to give you a location of where they are. The first viaduct I'm going to talk about is Care Viaduct. This was actually constructed in 1853 on the Limerick to Waterford line. The second viaduct is Slatty Viaduct. This was constructed a little bit later in 1862, and this was on a different line, on the Cork Cove line. And then the third and final viaduct I'm going to talk to you about is the River Fergus Viaduct, which was the last constructed in 1869, and this was on the Limerick to Athenry line. So firstly then, to locate the viaducts for you, The first one, as the name suggests, Care Viaduct, is actually located in Care, in the town of Care, in Tipperary. The second viaduct, Slatty Viaduct, this is located just east of Cork City, and north of the town of Cove. And then the third viaduct, River Fergus Viaduct, is located in Ennis, in County Clare. So we look firstly at Care Viaduct. As I say, it's on the Limerick to Waterford line. It's located very close to the town of Care and to Care Castle. It's located here where the line crosses over the River Shure, indicated by the red circle, and that's just west of the existing station in Care Station. So we look at the existing arrangement or outline of the existing structure. It consists of a three span Fairbourne box. It has a total span of close to 86 metres, a central span of close to 15 metres, and then two external spans of 18.5 metres. As I say, it's a Fairbourne, double Fairbourne box. One thing to note here is you will see the very ornate piers and the abutments. These were constructed at that time to mimic the history or the heritage of the Care town and also the Care castle. Looking then across section, the main structures are the two boxes. These are Fairbourne boxes. They were originally designed by William Fairbourne in 1853, but the design was patented by him in 1846. It uses the two boxes as a very stiff shape. This resists the bending and gives it more stiffness. At the base then you have transverse girders which span across between the two boxes, and they in turn support the track, the rails. What you will note here is that we have what are referred to as timber way beams. These are longitudinal timbers which support directly underneath the rail. So here we have that arrangement, upstream and downstream girder. A number of incidents have occurred on this viaduct over the years. The first one that I'm going to talk about is a collapse in 1955. This occurred when a locomotive pulling beet wagons from Waterford collapsed through the Waterford end span. This is a shot from the deck level where you can see of the 22 beet wagons, 12 of them collapsed down into that Waterford span. This is a view from the track level. And this is showing the collapse into that span, all the beet wagons there collapsed. What I will say that unfortunately the driver and the firemen of the engine were actually killed, unfortunately. However, this is a plan laid of the reinstatement which occurred at that Waterford end span. There were 18 girders, they were steel, were installed to replace those existing wrought iron transverse girders. So this is the plan laid, showing the two boxes and then the transverse girders and then the Waterford end being replaced. Following on from that, there was a further collapse in 2003, in October, when a cement bogie train travelling from Limerick to Waterford collapsed through the deck. Here, the rear wagons derailed and they pulled the wagons into the deck and collapsed. A shot from the riverbank, you can see where the cement bogies have collapsed through into the river. Because the locomotive had got across to the Waterford end, when the end 12 cement bogies derailed, they were actually pulled forward. In doing so, when they collapsed through, they pulled a lot of the transverse girders along and out of the boxes, which is shown here. Also, this shot shows the extent of the damage and also shows you how many of the transverse girders which were pulled out. There was quite extensive damage occurred to the viaduct. In addition to that, you can see the very severe local damage which occurred to the boxes. The boxes remained, but the bases, the base area of the boxes where the transverse girder had been, were torn apart. The transverse girder was pulled out and damaged the web of the boxes. However, a decision was made to reconstruct the viaduct and get the line back in operation. We initially looked at a replacement of the boxes. We considered a half-through truss structure for the main span and also two plate girders for the two end spans. However, we decided against this and decided it was a better option to retain the existing box girders, but to carry out strengthening of those. To do this, we came up with a solution of using a hanger frame to span up and over and to clamp the boxes. In addition to that, we provide a composite concrete deck which would be closed, so it wouldn't be open anymore. That would give protection to the transverse girders. In addition to that, the rail itself would be held in a rail polymer, which is generally referred to as embedded rail. There are different proprietary products, similar to what you may be aware of, the Lewis in the city centre. It's an epoxy product. It's poured around the rail and securely holds the rail in position. So that was the benefit that we had with this solution. In addition to that, at certain locations on the box, we also put in additional diagonal bracing, which you can see on the left and right. That's to strengthen the box internally to give it more stiffness internally for the webs. But importantly, the hanger frame to clamp the boxes themselves. So we did carry an assessment of that. Because the original structure had been constructed to carry twin tracks, we had additional capacity in the boxes. So provided that we clamped them and gave them the lateral restraint, we were able to implement this new solution. In addition to that, on the approaches, we decided to also put in protection, which is referred to as guardrail protection, so that if a train was to derail, not on the structure, but on the approaches, this would bring the train back in and allow it to run onto the deck. Even though it wouldn't be on the rails, it still would be caught. So that gave us added protection. So the first step which occurred was the repair of the wrought iron girders. The actual work itself was packaged together and it was awarded to John Molum Construction in February of 2004. The steelwork repairs and the installation of the new hanger frames was undertaken by LMPH Engineering and subcontracted to John Molum. This is a shot showing the repairs to the base of the box girders having been undertaken and underway and nearly in completion. As I said, internally inside the box, we also introduced some additional bracing. That's to stop the box bending or twisting internally. So that's a shot showing that occurring there. This is a shot showing a lot of the repairs having been undertaken and nearing completion, I should say, sorry. This is a shot then showing the first of those new deck hanger frames being installed. You will note in the background and also in the foreground that we left in a number of the existing transverse girders which were remaining. That was so that they restrained the box to allow us to get the new hanger frames into position and then lock the box. So this work proceeded until we had the majority of the hanger frames in. We did this from a land position. This shot shows the first of the hanger frames being installed using a rail mounted crane. This was on the section of transverse girders which were in position, which hadn't been damaged. And we used this to work from the centre of the viaduct back to the Limerick end, the end that we couldn't get at. So as we worked back, we progressively took out the existing transverse girders and installed the new hanger frames. This is another shot showing that fairly well progressing. You can see the rail crane in the background. I also point out that we have quite an extensive number of shear studs, which was for the new concrete deck. This is so that it could act compositely with the hanger frames. So following on from that, we had the installation of the reinforcement for the new composite concrete deck, which is occurring here. And then following on from that, then we had the installation of the new concrete deck itself, which is pouring here. You will note just in the foreground, you'll see the shapes. That was to create the upstands to hold the new rails in the embedded rail securely in position. So following on from that, then with the concrete cast, this is the start of putting in the new embedded rails. So you can see the rails here, and they've been put into those two upstands, and then the rail polymer poured. This is the final shot showing the end of the works, showing the approach. You can see here clearly the new concrete deck, the hanger frames, also the rail embedded in the upstands, so securely held in position. It's also important, it's a closed deck, so it's closed In addition to that, we have, just in the foreground, you can see where you've got the gather rails, as I said, there to bring the train back into position if it was to derail on the approach. And then this is the final completed elevation, just downstream, close to the town of Kerr, looking north. Obviously, after the incident had occurred, there was a review of this type of construction of the timber way beam. In the report into the incident at that time, it indicated that the likelihood of the derailment was caused by the interaction between the stiff bogey, cement bogies, and the way beam system itself, possible degradation there. So the review internally within Irish Rail to review this type of viaduct where we have a timber way beam. So that followed on into a period of work to assess these structures and to come up with an alternative system or put in a means of mitigating the way beams. So this leads me on then to the next viaduct I'm going to talk about. This is Slatty Viaduct. So again, just to locate where we are, we're just east of Cork City. It's on the Cork Cove line, and it's located very close to Fotel Station here. A little bit more detail, it's located between Harper's Island to the north and Fotel Island to the south. Again, as I say, it's very close to Fotel Station. Some of you may be aware of Fotel, the wildlife park there. The viaduct here crosses over the blue area there, which is a tidal area, and it's referred to as Slatty Waters, so hence the name Slatty Viaduct. The viaduct itself, then, it consists of two approach masonry spans and then six wrought iron half-through bowstring arch girders, each of a span of approximately 21.3 metres, and the total span is 137 metres. So the top view, you have the elevation. In the plan view, you can see the layout of the deck. You have a combination of longitudinal girders and transverse girders, which pick up the load from the railway and transport it back to the bowstring arches. In cross-section, then, we have the lattice arrangement for the bowstrings themselves, and also we have the timber way beams. They're sandwiched between those longitudinal members, which are generally referred to as rail bearers. Here we've got a double pair, the timber way beam in the centre, supporting the rail. The whole span itself is sitting or supported by the cast iron bearings, and that in turn is supported on the cast iron piers. So a shot of a section of the existing bowstring arches themselves. You can see here, this is three spans. A view then from the underside, you can see the arrangement of the transverse girders, which bring the load back to the bowstrings, and also those twin rail bearers, which run longitudinally between the transverse girders. A little bit more detail, it's a little bit hard to see, unfortunately, but those pair of rail bearers, they have little intermediate stools, and into those sit the timber way beams. And then finally, then you have the cast iron bearings, which support the structure, and that sits on and is supported by the cast iron piers. Initially, we had considered a replacement of the existing bowstrings. We considered a half-through plate girder structure with a ballasted track, a continuous welded rail. Obviously, the issues of the problems with that were that we would have to do substantial work to the approach embankments up to the viaduct, which would have been very costly. Also, given our proximity to Fotel railway station, it meant we had to do a lot of reconfiguration works to the platforms and so on. So we decided against this. Also, the access, it's quite a remote location to get to for access for heavy plant, so it would have been quite costly. So we decided against that. We went again for a concrete composite deck in combination with the existing structure, and again the embedded rail system. So we looked at the assessment of the existing bowstring arches, and we found that we could get this to work with the concrete composite deck and the bowstring arches. We did have to do some additional strengthening work to the bowstring arches themselves just to get additional capacity there. So looking at the concrete composite deck, we had to connect the concrete to the wrought iron. Obviously, being wrought iron, if you remember back to the Care Viaduct where you had all the shear studs or steel, we couldn't weld the shear studs to the wrought iron here. So we developed the use of an extra long high-strength friction grip bolt as a stud connector. This was a non-standard system at that time. Obviously, the HSFG has been subsequently changed by the new Eurocode, but for ease of reference, I'm going to continue to reference to the HSFG through the presentation. So to allow us to use the shear stud in this way, we instigated a series of laboratory testing with Trinity College to give it a confidence in the use of the HSG in this way. This is the laboratory test frame in Trinity College where we used to test the HSG as a stud connector. To do this, what we did, we got sections of beam cast concrete blocks to act or mimic the concrete composite slab, and also used the long HSFG as the connector between the steel beam and the concrete sections. This is a steel section. We also did a wrought iron, because obviously we're doing the structure we're working with is a wrought iron structure. So we did another test of a wrought iron beam, two concrete slabs again to mimic the composite concrete, and then the long shear studs. This is a view showing the tests, the results of the tests. There was various failure modes. Some failed by pullout of the long HSFG stud from the concrete, but the predominant failure mode was the shearing of the HSFG connector stud. From that, we were able to plot a series of graphs. In fact, we did six tests, two with a steel beam and four with a wrought iron. But they all gave us a fairly reasonable consistency in the failure modes, and that gave us confidence in what we were doing and able us to progress with the works. So looking at the works themselves on site, the first operation was the erection of a scaffold to get access to the bowstring arches and to carry out the works. This is a shot showing the scaffold progressed. Again, it's possibly not terribly clear, but just slightly in the foreground, you see where the shear studs are being installed. The benefit of that was that it allowed us to carry out the works without affecting the normal operations of the line. So at the moment, the line is operational. Even though we're working, do carrying out the work, the line is still operational, so we're not affecting the normal operational trains. I did mention that we had to carry out some strengthening of the bowstrings themselves. This is a shot shown here where we install an additional channel. This is the browner material. That's additional channel which is attached and bolted to the existing bowstring arch, which is the built-up section. We then did take a shutdown of the railway, and then we progressed with the installation of the composite concrete deck. This is very similar to the previous slide I showed you for Care Viaduct, so it went along the same, or progresses in a very similar manner. Because of the very exposed nature of the site, it's a tidal location, it is very exposed, it has the extremes of the water, we took the decision to erect a complete enclosure. This gave us confidence in completing the concrete works in the shutdown of the railway, which is a very limited amount of time, and also to progress the installation of the embedded rail, so we had control of the environments with the enclosure. This is the installation of the embedded rail. So you've got the two rails in those completed upstands, and we're pouring the rail polymer, which is an epoxy. Following on from that, the concrete deck installed, the embedded rail in, rails in position. We carried out then the blasting works for the new protective treatment of the bowstring, the wrought iron, and then the new channel had been installed. This is a shot then showing that protective treatment progressed, and you can see here the various colours. That's the stripe coating for the different layers in paint, so it gives you control of what's occurring, the different layers that are happening on site. This then is a shot showing you then the completed structure, the bleeding of the painting, and also the new concrete deck being finished and completed. This is a shot then showing where it's easier to see. We have the new concrete upstands, the embedded rail. So again, it's a completely closed deck from where we had previously it was an open deck. And then this is the final shot of the completed elevation. So I'm going to go and talk to you now about the third viaduct and show you how we took this idea of using the system with the HSFG and progressing it on to a slightly different variation of that. This is the River Fergus Viaduct. As I say, it's located very close to the town of Ennis in Clare. So just locate the viaduct itself. It's where the Limerick to Athenry line crosses over the Fergus. It's just north of the existing railway station in Ennis town itself. This is a view on the approach to the viaduct. You will note that it's completely different than the other ones, where all the supporting structure is below the rail. Again, you've got the rail, you have your timber rail beams, and you've all your decking timbers. This is an elevation showing the viaduct. It's a continuous structure, which is different than the other structures, or slatty, I should say. It has a total length of 62 metres. It's supported on a combination of concrete piers and steel piers. These actually were installed to replace an original timber piers foundations. So it's gone through several changes to structure. Just looking at the primary members itself, you have two built-up wrought iron beams. They're approximately 800 mm deep. They have plan bracing and also vertical lateral bracing. These support the longitudinal decking timbers, and the way beam sits on top of that. So it's all supported. All the structure is downstand from the rail, as opposed to the other structures where it's above the track. Again, we look to use the long HSFG to connect the wrought iron to the concrete. However, here, what we did, we developed this, or progressed it, the system along a little bit further, where we used a precast concrete deck and precasted all the elements. The elements for the support of the rail, they were all precast as well. And also, we had a walkway, which was a separate steel structure, just to give us the additional width on the, as you look at it on the left-hand side of the screen. So the first operation then was the removal of the timbers, the rail, those long waving timbers, and the installation of the HSFD steel connectors. In addition to that, what I should have said to you, we actually added an additional top flange to give us more tolerance for the installation of the precast units and also more capacity. This is a longitudinal view then showing that new top plate been installed, the HSFG steel connectors. So this was installed progressively. So as we worked our way off, in the background you see the machine, and then it's been stripping all the timbers, the way being the rails, and we're installing the new structure. I should say as well, we put in additional cross bracing, vertical, and also plan bracing. So with that installed, then we began installing new precast concrete deck sections. I say they were in sections. Also, they had pockets so that we could cast and connect the concrete to the rod, the new HSFG studs. So that work progressed. So you can see it progressing here, and we're nearing the end of that task. Again, you can see the pockets more clearly, and then the stitches between the units. And then that's all the units in. You will notice that we have the pockets, the stitches between the units, and also the vertical dowels. They were to receive the new precast upstands for the rail itself, which is shown here. So we precasted everything here. They were dropped in, and then they were connected with the dowels and grouted so that we had a complete structure. So that progressed along, that's all complete, and now we're pulling in the new rails into position. And again, because we have to get the control, we've got a shutdown of the railway, we have to get control of the work we're doing. So here we again erect an enclosure, we're placing new rails, and then we're going to pour and install the embedded rail. This then is a shot then of the completed final structure, where you can see this is the approach. You can see the new concrete deck, the upstands, the rail, the embedded rail, and then just on the left then that's the new walkway which was attached and came in separately as well. And then finally then you can see the completed aerial view of all of the concrete deck sections, the handrail and the walkway. And then this is the final completed elevation showing the new concrete deck and then the existing wrought iron girders below. Well, that completes my presentation, and I'd be delighted to take any questions that you may have. Thank you.
Hey, thanks very much, Aidan. That was great. I'm just going to open up to the floor. If you have any questions, if you could just raise your hand and just say your name and ask Aidan a question. Yep, Marcus.
Yeah, I actually have two questions. But the first question is in relation to the hedge-effect bolts just as shear connectors. Sure. It's very interesting, actually. Did you actually compare the slippage to force curve with, like, say, the existing ones for shear studs, for example, and whether they're more flexible or not?
No, we didn't. No, we only looked at our particular application.
Okay.
We didn't, because it's a wrought iron structure, we couldn't weld to it.
Yeah, fair enough. Yeah,
weld to it, so we had to deviate. At that time, we were using BS 5400 Part 5, so it allowed you to do this, provided that you had the testing to back it up. So
yeah.
We used Trinity College to do the testing for us, to give us the confidence. And again, we did the steel beam as a reference, so that was a smooth surface where the wrought iron structure.
Fair enough, yeah.
Yeah.
And did you check again, like, say, if there was an influence in the torque applied to the bolt? Whether if you, for example, had a lower torque, would it actually change the behavior or the capacity?
No, again, because the HSFG, we just wanted to use the standard one, but get one that was longer. Right. It would use the standard method of using the flat washer and the loading washer. Our own internal bridge maintenance staff install them, so the only way that they can do that is using the system as it is. It comes with, the bolt assembly comes with a loading kit and washer.
Mm-hmm.
Once that's torqued to the torque for that particular bolt, the load indicating or the indications on the washer collapses.
Yeah.
So it had to be suitable for us, our own maintenance people, to install it. We couldn't do something special that we could adjust the torque.
Okay.
It wouldn't be suitable for us to do that.
Okay. And last question, in the second bridge, you were saying that you need to actually strengthen the arches as well.
That's right.
But you didn't need to strengthen any of the hangers or other elements to work
on. No, everything was fine. It was just the bowstring. Because it's a half-true structure, it's subject, obviously, to the lateral torsion buckling.
Mm-hmm.
So to compensate for the additional dead load which we're putting on, we strengthened those. But apart from that, the rest of the structure was fine. It was a double-track structure, so it has more capacity.
Okay. Yeah. Very interesting, actually. Thanks.
Is that anybody else's question? Yeah. A few. Could I just get into that?
Hi, my name is Colin Colgan. The first bridge that we looked at failed after 100 years. Then there was some rehabilitation work, failed again after 50.
Sure.
Was there some misconduct in the 2003 failure? And what's the design life after these most recent rehabilitation projects?
Sure. No, back to the original one in 1955, the existing wrought iron transverse girders, they were replaced with steel girders. Obviously, they were stronger, so there was no issue with there. In 2003, the issue there, the report into that found that it was the interaction between the bogies of the cement wagon, they're quite stiff, and also possible degradation in the timber way beams. That timber way beam system is very problematic because obviously the subject is out in the environment, so it's subject to rot, wet, and so on. So you're constantly having to maintain it. But in that case, it was just, if you like, the interaction between the two, the cement bogies being quite stiff, less able to deal with possible movement, and also the degradation, if you like, in the system. It's very much subject if you have any movement to the rail, so the bogie being very stiff, then it's more like, if you like, the jump or twist. So the report found that it was likely the end wagons which derailed. So once they derailed, they pulled the other ones off. And then because the loco was going forward, then it caused extensive damage because they collapsed, pulled through, and the loco going forward and effectively pulled all the transverse girders out. So if it had been just, if you like, sitting there and flipped over, it wouldn't cost as much damage. The fact that it was still moving along, it caused extensive damage because the loco got across to the other side.
Okay. And then the design life for all
The design life. Yeah, we have done, obviously, as part of the work, we go through the different checks. We looked at the fatigue life. For all of the three examples, we were projecting that we would probably have an additional fatigue life beyond 50 years, and then beyond that again. It's obviously the fatigue life is to do with your stress ranges and your connectors. You can obviously put that back up or progress it up again, increase the fatigue life again by going back in, doing review, inspections, find out what connectors, the rivets or the HSFG connectors, which some of them might be fractured. So you can go back in again in so many years' time and bring yourself back up again. But for the structures as they are, there's definitely at least 50, 60 years additional life in them.
Great. Cool. Thank you.
Thanks. Anybody else?
I'm Trevor Wood, and thank you very much, Aidan, for those three presentations. Just in relation to the first bridge, you noted about the box girders at the ends, at the edges supporting the main part of the bridge. In relation to ongoing kind of inspection regimes and that, was any allowance made for inspection hatches so those boxes could be inspected internally? And then secondly, on the third bridge, the Fergus viaduct, in relation to the amount of work that was undertaken, and right in front of us there is the kind of main supporting structure of the four piers that are sitting in the river itself, was there consideration given to actually just replacing that whole bridge rather than kind of doing a lot of extensive work to the main bridge deck, but not really kind of anything to the piers themselves that obviously sit in a river environment and potentially prone to kind of flooding occurrences, but also especially the two middle piers, issues with kind of protecting that steelwork?
Sure, yeah, your first question, what I might actually do, I'll go in here again if I can, and rerun this again. Yeah, just the first question, the exit hatches, there is a case in point. We created some larger openings so that we had a bigger panel, so if we want to go back in the future, we can get access into the box girder. So they're particularly located at particular locations on the box. So yeah, we did do that. We did consider that. So, something we did do. Your second question on the Fergus. Obviously, the structure has had quite a bit of work done on the foundations. We did do some local repairs to the concrete work, or the concrete piers, the pylons there. But it has been functioning. A lot of our structures go through various different stages in their life, so we're quite happy to deal with that as it occurs. That original structure had timber, that was a complete originated timber trestle structure. So I suppose in railway we take the view that the structures are constantly changing, and you see this presentation is all about continuing and improving the life of our structures. So we're sort of happy to, there's something we accept that we have to do. Maybe that, does that answer your question? Or on your second part?
Part of it. Kind of,
was it looked at
in relation to potentially replacing that?
Oh, sorry, looked at? Okay, well, looked at, yes, in terms of capacities, yeah, it has the capacities, and there was local repairs on the concrete section, which we had to do. In terms of the appearance of it, yes, I suppose you could argue that we should have done something with the appearance, but again, our structures are very functional. We take the view they have got to do a job for us. That's equally the reason why, I suppose, we retained a lot of the structures here. By doing some work, we're able to increase the lifespan of the structure, and it's doing the work for us. So why tear it all apart? And I mean, if you were to do work to the supporting structure there, that's quite major, extensive. So you've got a huge cost just to improve the aesthetics. You can't really justify that. Our structures have got to do the work for us to be functional. As I say, that structure, the Fergus, has gone through various stages in its life. But we accept that in the railway, the structures are constantly evolving. We have to do things with them. So is that a better answer to your question? No? Yes?
Okay.
Okay, maybe one more question if there is, and if not, we'll break for coffee. Anyone else got a question? One last one? Okay, I'd just like to thank Aidan very much for his presentation. It was really informative. And there should be coffee outside in the bar, so if you just say we break for maybe 25 minutes, be back here in around 4 o'clock, be great. Thanks very much.
Just for the third lecture. Third lecture is asset management of the railway slope network. Sorry guys, let's start our final one. Lecture 3 is asset management of the railway slope network by Paul Doherty and Catherine Joyce. Catherine Joyce is a chartered engineer with Irish Rail. working in the Athlone Divisional Office. Catherine has 10 years' experience and has worked as a bridge designer and design site representative on motorway projects with RPS Consulting Engineers before moving to Irish Rail in 2011. At Irish Rail, Catherine is a structures inspector working on cuttings and embankments, bridges and culverts. Catherine is project manager for the recently completed cuttings and embankment decision support tool. Catherine will be co-presenting with Paul Doherty. Paul is the managing director of the specialist engineering consultancy GDG. Having graduated from UCD with a BE honours degree, he went on to specialise in geotechnical engineering. Paul has worked on a range of consultancy projects, including earthworks, optimization, slope stability design, offshore foundation engineering, and geotechnical instrumentation and monitoring. Paul has completed a PhD on the topic of pile design in 2010 and has published over 50 technical articles on geotechnics and foundations. This presentation today will focus on the requirements for a slope stability risk model for the Irish Rail network, overview of Irish Rail cutting and embankment characteristics, slope analysis and the drivers for instability, development of a detailed slope and asset inventory, defining the framework of a probabilistic approach to slope modelling, vulnerability and consequence analysis of railways, consideration of train factors, etc. So Catherine will speak first. Thanks.
Okay, so I'm going to introduce the Irish Rail network. We're going to look at our infrastructure asset management system, how earthworks are inspected, and a few case studies showing failures we've had on the network and remediation works we've carried out since. And hopefully, when I finish talking, you'll understand the sheer work involved in inspecting our assets, how serious the failures can be, how unpredictable they are, and how expensive it is to fix them, and why we need a new way of working. And this is why we've developed a decision support tool. Okay. So on the Irish Rail network, there is 2,800 kilometres of track. We have 3,700 cutting and embankment assets. So they range in length from maybe 30 metres long to over a kilometre. We have 3,700 bridges and another over 1,000 culverts. And we have 995 open level crossings. The network is managed by three divisional offices, Athlone in the west, Dublin in the east, and Limerick Junction covers the south. When I started in 2011, I worked in Limerick Junction, and a year ago I moved to the Athlone office. So to manage our assets on the network, we have an infrastructure asset management system, IAMS. It has two components, a GIS viewer, which is a mapping tool that shows the assets visibly on a map, and we have SAP PM, which is software that houses our asset register, our inspections, any records of faults on the assets, our work bank, and other modules for finance and document management. So if we look at the GIS viewer, this is the mapping tool showing the earthwork assets. So the yellow dashed lines are embankments. The light blue lines are soil cuttings, and the navy lines are rock cuttings. If we take one asset in particular, this is a rock cutting in Rathpeakin, just outside of Cork, on the Dublin-Cork line. It's 17.5 metres high, it's at a 70 degree slope, and it's covered in vegetation. There's about 1.4 metres clearance from the toe of the cutting to the running edge of the track at its critical location. You might be able to see the orange dot. That's my lookout. So it's important I can see him too. When you click on the asset in the GIS viewer, the asset information housed on SAP comes up. So it has the height, slope, vegetation, the drainage details, and obviously the unique identifier and the start and end mileages. On SAP, our inspection card is there. So it's a handwritten card, and it also would have a photographic report to go with it. On the inspection card, the top grid shows the basic asset information, its unique identifier, its serial number, its start and end mileages, and the height and slope, just the basic information. The second grid is for condition and deterioration indicators. So what type of drainage we have, is there drainage issues like seepage and ponding, is there animal burrows, signs of failures, a history of failures, and there's a lot of indicators there, and we fill that out. And the most critical thing on that section is the condition rating, which gives an overall view of the condition of the asset, and that will tell you how often it gets inspected. There's a section for the inspector to write notes on the asset and a sketch box at the bottom to draw the critical section and show any defects. So when I started in 2011, there wasn't an asset register for the cutting and embankments in Limerick Junction. So first thing we had to do was identify all our assets. Once that was done and the initial inspection was carried out, we set up an inspection schedule. Since then, so since 2012, we've been carrying out engineering inspections of the assets and identifying works needed at the assets. So how do you identify your assets? You can't just go out and start walking, you need to plan it. So first of all, you arrange lookouts. This has to be done a couple of weeks in advance. You have to talk to the permanent way inspector that manages that area track. To know how long you need a lookout for, you need a realistic estimate of how much distance you can cover in a day. So for me, starting off, I covered about 3 miles a day, setting up assets, identifying them, inspecting them, and writing my reports. By the end, we were covering about 5 miles. So when you have the whole network to walk, it takes about 7 months to walk it. You need access points and maps and lists of features so you can keep track of where you are, any landmarks along the way. And also, because it's a railway, you can't just access it anywhere, like a road. You have to drive to a point and then there might not be another access point for a couple of miles. And the last thing you want to do is walk it twice. So you set up a car either end. There's a lot of logistics, a lot of planning goes in. And then you go to site. So for us, we're spending maybe 6 hours a day walking. You want to bring the right amount of stuff, but not too much stuff. So obviously a GPS logger to mark the start and end coordinates of the asset, measuring tape, a camera, an inclinometer. The best thing we found was a magnetic angle finder. It costs €6. It fits in your pocket, and it's really, really helpful. That plus a slash hook actually gives you a longer length to measure the angle over instead of just that much. And a slash hook is helpful for climbing up and down the embankments or the cuttings to actually look at them. And a weatherproof report writer because you're out in all weather. And then we just walked. So went from Limerick to Waterford, Portlaoise to Cork, Mallow to Tralee, Cork to Cove, Clontarf to Middleton, and the Nina branch. The Nina branch is the one in the middle. It's 50 miles long, so it counts. And yeah, so we're out in all weather. Lookouts were great, and there was trains. So when you to set up the inspection schedule, once we'd all the assets identified and an initial inspection carried out, we used a condition rating to set up the inspection frequency. So an asset in good condition was given a rating of 1, so that's inspected every 6 years. Assets in fair condition with minor defects are rated as condition 2. And are inspected every 4 years. Assets in poor condition with significant structural defects, they're inspected every 2 years. And assets rated condition 4 are very poor. They need mitigation measures and they need to be inspected at least every year. Mostly we set up extra inspections to deal with them though. So how would you rate this asset? It's in good condition. It's an even gradient. It's covered in vegetation. There's no signs of defects. So this is a condition 1, gets inspected every 6 years. This asset is on the Sligo line, because I've been working in Athlone the last year, so new assets to show you. It's in fair condition, has minor defects. The upper slope is steeper than the lower slope. There's moss in the lower section, so that's an indicator of poor drainage. And there is a retaining wall at the toe. Our assets aren't a new design standards. They're 150 years old in general, so you inherit a lot of old issues. So this asset is in fair condition, but it's not in good condition, so condition rating 2. This is an asset on the Mallow-Tralee line, the 43-mile post. It's fractured rock, fractured mudstone up high, so this is a condition 3. It also has a narrow cess, the distance from the toe to the running edge. So failures are going to end up on the track. So condition 3. And this is on the Belfast line. It's a condition 4. It's in very poor condition. It's prone to regular rock falls. and mitigation measures such as netting have been put in place. So once we've done our inspections, we identify follow-up works. These can be maintenance activities like clearing out the drains, remediation works like soil nailing and netting, extra inspections, particularly for assets in poor and very poor condition, mitigation measures, maybe speed restrictions, and we update the risk register for high-risk assets. But we've 3,700 assets, so it's a lot of work. That's 20 cards, and we have now over 4,500 inspections carried out. So it's extremely difficult to manage it, the scale of assets that we have. So we've had failures. This is Manila Junction in Mayo. Unfortunately, this happened a day after remediation work started on the embankment. It had differential settlement issues, so vegetation was cleared and the toe was excavated to start off the improvement works, and overnight the embankment failed. There was a derailment in 2008 in Port Arlington. The cause of this was ponding in the adjacent field, insufficient drainage in the adjacent landowner's land, and the cutting became saturated and the train derailed. In Wicklow, this happened when there was a road project going on in the area. The contractor gave the farmer soil that had been excavated, and he spread it over his land, inadvertently blocked the drains. When the drainage wasn't working, the cutting became saturated. That's a cutting 13 metres high, and ended up on the track and the train derailed. In Tullamore, it's a limestone cutting. It's fractured, and after the winters of 2010 and 2011, cold winters, the freeze-thaw action caused the joints to expand and contract, and the failures happened as a result. Cabra had a series of failures in January and February 2012. This was due to like prolonged heavy rain in January and February, and there was slips on the network there. In Kilkenny to Waterford, on that line, there was a landslip in 2013. This was also caused by ponding in the adjacent land and inadequate field drainage. So things outside of Irish Rail's control, the cutting became saturated and slipped onto the track. In 2013, in December, there was the failure in Waterford Station. Some of you might be aware of it from the news coverage of it. This cutting reaches 30 metres high, and when the failure happened, it covered two tracks at the station. On the Cork Cove line, there is at Rushbrook, there was a major failure in March 2014. In the area, the rock, it's a rock cutting about 6 meters high, and it's 70 to 80 degrees slope. The road at the top of the cutting doesn't have drainage, and a lot of water comes onto the track from that road. So the failure happened overnight. There was works going on in the area, so they were able to find the fault before trains ran in the morning, stop the trains. It's hard to get the scale of this failure, but 40 tons of material were cleared from the track there. So since these failures have been happening, we've been carrying out remediation works. Some on high risk assets like this one hadn't actually experienced a failure, but it was likely to fail. So in winter 2013, we did soil nailing and meshing, regrading above gabions and meshing them also. We did the work at night, so we were able to have trains running during the day, which is very important for us because we need to try keep the business going. After the Rushbrook failure, we anchored a retaining wall that was there, that was in very poor condition. We did soil nailing, we installed drainage and shotcreting, and meshed an area as well. To facilitate these works, we had to shut down the line outside of peak hours. In Bray Head last year, serious works were carried out here. It's a 15 metre high cutting, and they meshed it and nailed it. Here's a few more photos. On the Malatralee line, last year they were doing rock combing at the 41 mile post. And the 43 mile post is the cutting we saw earlier, the condition 3 one with the fractured rock. So It's been rock combing and regrading carried out here. These are all very expensive projects, though, and take about a year to plan if we just shut down the track, so they're major undertakings. So to have a quick look at where we've come in the last few years, in 2011, the assets were identified and initial inspections carried out. 2012, we started the routine cyclical inspections, but rock falls and slips have continued to happen on the network. So we need a new way of identifying where failure is going to happen. So in 2014, we took the decision to develop a decision support tool. In the last month, we have had results from this model, and we've calibrated them, and they are very realistic results. And next year, we hope to start investing in the higher risk assets. So just to tie it all up, the reasons that we need a decision support tool is, you've seen how we rate our assets. It's a condition 1 to 4 rating. We collect a lot of information when we're on site, but it all gets boiled down to a condition rating score that is from 1 to 4. So it's a very basic score, and we end up with hundreds of assets in the condition 3 and a few in the condition 4 rating category. So you still don't know which assets to target and which ones are at the top of the priority list and which ones are the lower down priority. So even in that condition rating of 3. We've seen some of the failures. They're difficult to predict. They literally happen overnight. You might have noticed they're often caused by forces outside our control, adjacent landowners and heavy rainfall events. When they happen, they're very expensive to remediate. Remediation costs about 10 times what earlier intervention would have cost. So if we could have done maintenance beforehand, we'd save a lot of money and be able to target a lot more track. Any of the remediation works I showed you, that's improving maybe 300 meters or 500 meters of cuttings. But we have 1,300 kilometers of earthworks to deal with. So improving a couple of hundred meters of cuttings or embankments every year won't come to terms with our network fast enough. When assets are rated as high risk or when a failure happens, we want to have procedures in place for dealing with those failures. And for budget holders, the people that actually make these remediation works happen, we need a decision support tool that will help them select the right activity. So if maintenance work is sufficient, how high a risk the asset is, and what level of work is required to bring it down to a tolerable risk rating. So a decision support tool and a cost-benefit analysis tool will enable us to manage our limited budget better. Paul is now going to show you how the tool is developed and what it can do. All right.
So we first got involved in the project about 2 years ago. We being GDG, it's a geotechnical engineering consultancy. We have about 30 staff, mainly based in Dublin, a few staff based in Scotland and Belfast. Predominantly, we specialise in soil structure interaction and geotechnical problems. So it's any way that structures or infrastructure interact with the ground. As Catherine was saying, there was a few kind of key drivers for developing the decision support tool. And I'd say those drivers aren't specific to the Irish rail network. They tend to be common across European infrastructure systems and networks that have been developed over the last 100, 200 years. And as the infrastructure ages and, in general, the slope assets degrade and that you start to see the influence of rainfall events and general wear and tear on the network, obviously you get failures as a result. And also then you have to reconcile the fact that on these networks we're not dealing with assets that are designed to Eurocode standards. We're not dealing with typical standard NRA specified slope angles of 27 degrees. These are very much assets that were designed for a certain function 150 years ago or 200 years ago. And now there's a legacy issue around maintenance and keeping the network functional. So in terms of what we were trying to achieve with the development of a risk model, it was to reduce the reliance on visual inspections. So we were trying to move away from the subjectivity with visual inspections and towards a more objective approach. We're also trying to incorporate some kind of scientific mechanism for how the slopes were failing. So if we could look at why do slopes stand up, why do slopes fail, and can we incorporate that somehow into the risk tool, so as it has a bit, it has good predictive basis. So if you change one of the drivers, if you add more weight to a slope, then the chances of failure, the probability of failure should go up, and therefore the risk should go up. So we're trying to capture kind of the fundamental mechanisms behind the slope stability. And ultimately, yeah, it was to get ahead of the problem. It was to go from reactive to predictive. So if we can say in advance that these are high-risk assets, invest in maintenance before it becomes a remediation problem, then obviously your capital, your budgets go much further. So the solution that we came to was to develop a risk management model. And that was based on kind of a traditional slope stability approach, but we also had to incorporate all of the existing information. Catherine talked through the painstaking lengths that she went through and her colleagues went through to gather all of the data that underpins the network and gives you the baseline data for all of the assets. We were very keen to incorporate as much of that information into the tool as we could. So as you have a scientific basis, but you also have all of the anecdotal stuff. If we have past records of historical slips, if we have any kind of anecdotal information there, that should get built into the ultimate risk score. And ultimately what we wanted to end up with was a decision support tool, a piece of software that was user-friendly and was practical in terms of giving risk output that you could use to make decisions around maintenance. So at the outset, we started off, we went through kind of a fact-finding mission. We're used to doing kind of individual slope stability and slope remediation projects where you look at kind of why did the slope fail, let's address that specific issue and come up with a remediation solution, design it out, hard engineering solutions, retaining walls, so on. This was a very much a different problem in that we had to take a bit of a higher look at the network and say, how do we treat risk for assets where we don't know a lot of the information? So we were looking at kind of generalized risk tools, and what we landed on was landslide-based risk mapping and landslide-based risk frameworks. And this kind of approach is reliant on certain things like triggering factors. So when we look at why do our slopes fail, and it's often related to rainfall events, then we need to make sure that the model that's developed incorporates those triggering factors and incorporates the influence of rainfall. Similarly, if we have preparatory factors, so if a slope is preconditioned to fail by having, say, undercut toe, that has to get built into the model. So we use kind of landslide risk frameworks in order as a kind of background to underpin the model development. Then we kind of took a step back and said, okay, why do slopes fail? And I'm just going to briefly run through the types of failure that we get, how they manifest on the Irish Rail network, and then I'll probably show some of the same pictures that Catherine just showed. So we have two kinds of limit states. Typically when we're talking about structures, we have ultimate limit state, serviceability limit state. Ultimate limit state being global collapse, and serviceability could be some kind of performance issues, it could be tension cracking on your slope, or it could be just that your slope is still usable, but potentially it requires additional maintenance that you hadn't otherwise designed for. So when we look at ultimate limit state failures, that kind of global slope failure would be pretty obvious. The serviceability limit state, less obvious. I went through a lot of pictures before I decided what do I call a serviceability limit state. That kind of localized, very small, shallow movement on the shoulder of the embankment could be classified as a serviceability limit state, in that something needs to be done before you get additional unraveling and then subsequent maintenance issues. So addressing it now would reduce the problems down the line. If we start looking at slope instability and landslide mechanisms, and then you have rock cuttings, soil cuttings, embankments, we end up with an awful lot, and then you have all kinds of natural terrain and combinations of them. So unfortunately, when we draw slopes as two straight lines or three straight lines, that's not the way it works in reality. We have concave slopes and convex slopes, and ones that have very steep localized portions and overhangs, and we have ones that are slightly more uniform. But in general, they don't lend themselves very well to traditional hand calculations where you have to make a lot of assumptions around it. They also don't lend it very well in terms of defining asset characteristics. So you say we'll take the maximum slope height of a cutting, or the maximum slope height of an embankment. But where are we taking the slope height to and from if the asset is up and down, the topography is changing? Same thing with angles. What's the maximum slope angle on an asset if our rock is going in and out and in and out? So in general, we end up with an awful lot of different possible failure modes. We have rock falls and debris flows and topples and so on, some of which are much more applicable to natural terrain than to railway infrastructure. So one of the first steps we had to do was identify the ones that were most prevalent for railway infrastructure and build them into the model. If they don't occur on the railway network, then we don't need to really account for them. So what we ended up with was looking at rock wedge failures, and then deep-seated rotational slips and translational slips. So translational slips make up most of the slope instability issues that we see on the rail network. And there's a good reason for that, which I'm going to get into in a second. In terms of rotational slips, they're much less frequent, but because they tend to involve a much more deep-seated failure mechanism, they tend to involve much higher volume of soil, and therefore they tend to be much more visible, and they can be much more catastrophic. So in terms of shallow translational slips or slides, they're typically 0.5 meter to 1.5 meters in depth. In a lot of cases, we get a nice planar surface, so you can actually see, after the failure, you can see a clear plane, sliding plane. They are actually quite frequent, but a lot of them are very small, so you don't necessarily see them. And they tend to be triggered by rainfall. So here's an example where we have two landslides or slope slips, relatively shallow, less than a meter. We have a crest at the top, and then you have debris that collects at the bottom. And you can define kind of the depths, you can define the boundaries of the slope. Runout in this case is relatively small. So you have the original toe of the slope, and you can see that the debris runout is pretty much at the slope location. So the impact that this kind of failure would have if there was a running rail here would be quite low, because it didn't actually go anywhere. But that is not the same for every slope failure. So there have been cases of slopes that have failed, and they've hit valleys, the opposite side of a valley, 3 or 4 kilometers away. So the runout can be quite significant. Here again, we can see two shallow translational slides, both very similar. In this case, both this one reaching the running rail, this one right beside the running rail. Here's two from Network Rail. On the one on the right, you can see that the initial source of the failure, as it gathered speed, it picked up a soft pocket of ground. Then it entrained more debris. As it entrains more debris, then it gets more momentum, and it causes more damage further downslope. So the only difference, exactly the same failure mechanism in both of these, except this had a much further runout distance. That's the same again, and that's one that actually caused the train derailment. Okay, so why are these shallow translational slides actually happening? What's going on? What's driving it? And if we take a step back and we look at when we design traditional road networks today, new motorway going from across the country, you're designing to about a 27 degree slope, which is the frictional strength of the material. So you say if you take just the friction, the internal strength within sand or gravel, that's what it'll stand up at based on its own inherent strength. if you look at the Irish rail network and you say a lot of the slopes actually stand at 35 degrees, 40 degrees, 50 degrees, 60 degrees, so it's standing at an angle that's twice as steep as it should theoretically stand up at, how is that happening physically? What's the mechanism behind it? And what's going on is you have below a water table, you have a hydrostatic head building up. But above the water table, where you have cuttings and embankments, you have negative pore pressures building up. So you have a suction value. And that suction actually holds the soil together and gives you an apparent cohesion. So it's not that the soil is cemented, there's no chemistry to it. It's purely negative pore pressures within the void space between the materials. And that has a hugely positive impact on the soil strength, which is a great thing. It allows these slopes to stand up. But it's also a temporal thing, in that you add moisture to the slope, the negative pore pressures start to decrease. The more moisture you add, the closer it gets to zero condition. Once it gets to zero, it can only stand up at its theoretical value, which is your 30 degrees or 32 degrees, depending on the angle of friction. So really it's about how can you maintain those negative pore pressures over the slope, and how can you guarantee their presence over the next 100 years or even through the next winter. And the way you do that is you make sure you have efficient drainage systems and you keep the slope from getting saturated. If the slope gets saturated, the negative pore pressures reduce, the soil strength reduces, the chance of failure goes up. Which is why if we look at all of the slope failures that have happened on the network, a lot of them have been preceded by heavy rainfall. And typically it might not be the first day of rainfall, but it could be a successive week of rainfall or several days that builds up the moisture within the ground, and eventually you get to no suctions. So basically what you have initially, you have a negative hydrostatic head from your water table up, and then as rainfall increases and percolates the ground, this profile changes back to where you have a zero condition. And typically once it gets to that, you start to get failures. So that's how translational failures occur. The other type of failure mechanism that we do see on the network is rotational slides. So big, deep-seated failures that typically involve a much higher volume of material, a much greater volume of material. They tend to be circular in shape, and they affect both cuttings and embankments. So that's a rotational slide. You can see the depth, you can actually see the rotation. And they tend to occur, they can occur after rainfall, but they're also driven a lot by ground conditions, soft material under an embankment, for example, rather than making up the embankment itself. What else? Quite sensitive to issues around toe stability. So if you were installing some kind of toe stability system, you can actually destabilize an embankment by adding extra weight to the bottom. So you need to consider the sequence of works when you're doing any kind of work to the toe. Let me see. Okay, so this is just a typical. In a lot of cases, we don't get any precursor to the failure. We don't get an indication of slope instability. We know a slope is high risk, but we don't actually see it failing until it fails. In a very small number of cases, you do get clear indicators such as bulging on the slope, which is suggesting that you're going to have a slip. The other thing which I'm not going to talk about is rock falls, which we did deal with within the model, but it's kind of its own separate topic. So just in terms of what we had to deal with in terms of the model development, the key that we wanted to get was a core algorithm that allowed us to consider those failure mechanisms and calculate an initial baseline probability of failure. That's the initial hazard assessment. Then we have the hazard assessment also has to, so what we were getting at from the hazard assessment is the probability of failure. Then we incorporate things that allow us to look at the vulnerability and the consequences. So within that, you need to consider, it's not just whether a slope is going to fail or not, it's also if a slope fails, what happens next? And we have cases where slopes can fail, relatively high probabilities of failure, relatively high risk of failure, but the actual risk to the asset could be low because the clearance between the running rail and the toe of the slope is high. So we need to consider what the impact on the rail is, and then if a slope failure was to impact on the rail, what's the chances of that impacting on a train? So it's a, if it's a very lightly trafficked line, then the risk would be less. If it's a very, if there's a lot of if there's a high train frequency, very densely trafficked route, then the risk would be higher. So what we ended up with was a three-stage process for the model. Stage one was about rationalizing all of the data and coming up with a consistent set of asset characteristics. Stage two then was about model refinement, undertaking the vulnerability assessment, and then finally stage three was coming up with a final model and decision support tool. So the first stage, we talked about these assets which are not regular, they're not uniform, there is no consistency about them at all, and yet we have to come up with a set of characteristics that allows us to compare an asset anywhere in the network with any other asset in order to dictate which is higher risk. So the way we went about that was we identified which were the key parameters we needed to know, and then how were we going to go about getting information for those parameters. Some of the parameters we couldn't actually get information for, and in order to address that, we often had to use proxy measurements to build a model around. So for example, one of the key things in any problem is geometry. So what are the geometry of our assets? Usually that's known. When you're dealing with a single problem, a single engineering design, whether it's a bridge or whether it's a building or whether it's a slope remediation, usually you know the geometry. You have a topo survey, you have detailed information about the asset. When you're dealing with these kind of assets over this kind of scale, you don't have that. So the first step that we had to do was to get that with a consistent methodology across the network. So Irish Rail had flown the network with LiDAR data, can't remember what year, 2011, so before we got involved. And what we did was then process that LiDAR data to pull out slope heights, slope angles for every asset, with a process and a definition that was consistent across the network. And we were then able to compare it to the existing information from the inspection cards and update the asset characteristics. And then in addition to that, we were also able to pull out things like adjacent land angle, which was also contributing to the risk. So that was one of the, while it was a lot of effort to go through cross-sectional slices every tens of meters across the entire network with LiDAR data, it was still relatively straightforward compared to how we came up with some of the proxies for things like soil information. So it's obviously not feasible to go out to your network and carry out a site investigation on every asset. Just can't do it. So we had to rely on background mapping combined with localized ground truthing to rationalize a set of soil characteristics for different assets and different asset classes. So we basically came up with a big map of the country and used that to say if our track is going through this and it's a cutting or if it's an embankment, it's likely to contain material X, Y, or Z. So we came up with our own soils map. Then we did a set of ground truthing to validate that. Ultimately, the output of this stage one was a fully populated set of asset characteristics that included drainage and included vegetation, as well as geometry and soils data. So this was other things that we included were historical inspection information, GPR data, failure records. So as well as the kind of hard geometry and the soils information that were driving the failure modes, we also had the anecdotal stuff around historical failure records. If a slope has failed in the past, it's more likely to fail again, and therefore we couldn't incorporate that in with the scientific calculation approach that we had. So we needed a separate way of getting that into the model. Just in terms of the LiDAR, typically that's a cross section for a relatively uniform embankment. You can see we have upside and downside for the track, and we were picking out kind of the embankment height, the slope angle, and the adjacent land angle. Also the distance from the running rail, so we could get the clearance from the LiDAR as well. We were also able to compare the physical and visual measurements, inspection measurements, to the LiDAR data. And one of the interesting observations was that in general, the slopes are quite steep, but the inspection information had the slopes steeper than the LiDAR data. And that's probably a function of just standing at the bottom of a cutting and looking up and seeing they tend to look very steep. Catherine will tell you more about it. Okay, so once we got to this point where we had a set of assets and a set of asset characteristics, we developed the core algorithm, which has a translational failure mode, rotational failure mode, and a wedge failure mode to account for the types of failure that we talked about earlier on. And basically, what happens in every asset is it runs each of the failure modes, calculates the probability of failure, and outputs the worst of the three. So, just very briefly, why did we go for a probabilistic-based approach rather than a factor of safety-based approach? And the answer is quite simple, lack of information. Because what we're trying to get to is a place where we can compare assets relatively one to another. If we had all the information, we could have used a factor of safety approach. We would have been relatively happy with that. But we're dealing with an imperfect world where we don't have all the information, where we're estimating the soils data from background mapping information, as an example. So what the probabilistic approach does is it puts a premium on knowing your information. If you go out and you do a site investigation and you actually know what your soil type is for your asset, then the risk for that asset goes down, everything else being equal, because you know more about it. And because of the probabilistic approach, we can account for the value of information within the model. Okay, so ultimately we get to a place where we have a probability of failure for each of these slopes. Then the next step is, that's a baseline probability of failure. It tells you a lot about the slopes, but it doesn't tell you the whole story, because we weren't able to account for things like vegetation, for slip history, for condition scores. And to get to a point where we could really have a probability of failure that we were happy with, we needed to account for all of this additional hazard analysis within the model. The way we did that was we came up with a degradation factor that then weights the baseline probability of failure to get to a secondary probability of failure. And that was done in close collaboration with Irish Rail and with everybody that's working on the assets on a day-to-day basis to determine if there's additional drivers that are causing failures, that gets built into the model. And then ultimately the next thing was the consequence analysis, where we say, okay, we now have a point where we know which are the highest probability of failure assets, but if those assets fail, what is the next step? What is the impact? And to look at that, we had to look at clearance, the number of tracks, the train frequency, the line speed. So if trains are going faster, the risk is increased. If the train frequency is higher, the risk is increased. And then ultimately, we ended up with a refined GUI. There's also built into this, there's a simple cost-benefit analysis tool where you can, which is currently being finalized, which allows you to compare on a network basis or on a line basis or on an asset basis. You can say, if I was to do a simple remediation approach and regrade, let's say all assets greater than 50 degrees back to 45 degrees, how does that change the risk profile of the network? And if you do that, how does that cost compare to doing something like maintaining your drainage system and improving your drainage? Drainage seems to be an easy win, given that a lot of the failures are caused by the suction mechanism. Maintaining a working and functioning drainage system helps keep the negative pore pressures, helps minimize the number of translational slides. So in terms of the output, basically what we end up with is, so you're looking at the number of assets here against probability of failure. So as you go to the right here, higher probability of failure is worse, obviously. So the baseline is the blue, the hazard is the red, and then the risk is the final score. And the actual numbers here don't mean anything, they don't make any difference. What we're trying to do is compare assets to assets. And one of the most important things to consider is that the profile of the blue, the red, and the green is very different, which means that it's not enough to consider how stable a slope is or isn't. It's actually about what the risk is at the end of the day to the assets and to the network. That's just a screenshot of the tool in operation. And then from that, you can do your own subsequent analysis. You can output Excel and graphics and PDFs and all that. Okay, so just to sum up, basically there's now detailed asset characteristics defined for all of the the artworks on the Irish Rail network. The risk model is that it covers the entire network and has the capability to analyze every asset. And it's underpinned by a probabilistic model, which means the more information you get and the more you know about your assets, the less risk you have across your network, or potentially you can reduce your risk. And one of the key things about this type of model is to incorporate historical experience and anecdotal evidence. Oh, and finally, when we started off working on this, we were working with a number of people. Sharon Callanan was heavily involved from the start and is now on maternity leave. Colin Mangan, Colin Bowe, and then we had a team working on this in the office as well.
I'm just going to open it up to the floor if there's any questions for Paul or Catherine. Just if you could just say your name and who you work for, that'd be great. Must have one question. I'll start it off, and it probably isn't relevant to your talk at all, but just in terms of asset management, so this is purely like a geotechnical asset management tool. I'm assuming that structures aren't put into that, or retaining walls or bridges or culverts. It's am I right in saying it's a completely independent sort of geotechnical asset management system?
That is a good question. There's a separate module that deals with retaining walls.
Okay.
But believe it or not, we actually have less information about the retaining walls than we do about the earthworks.
Okay.
So we have the tool is capable of running the same, it's a different module within the tool, can run the same analysis for retaining walls, but we don't have enough information to actually feed the model.
Okay.
And part of that is because when you do the LiDAR survey, the retaining wall assets are generally vertical, so even like the starting point, the geometry, we don't have. We have gravity walls, we have no idea what depth gravity wall actually is. We just know there's enough concrete there to stop it failing at the moment.
Okay.
So I think there's a exercise in intrusive works to get more information about the retaining walls to determine kind of which ones are high risk.
Okay, yeah. And just a second question I was just thinking about was, obviously the people that might know the rail network the best would be the drivers of the trains. And I don't know if you've presented this to them, but do they give feedback periodically in terms of, because obviously they'll notice differences, or they might know, you know, where there is rockfall, or they can maybe alert you to events that may happen. Does that feedback into this at all? Or?
Well, someone else in the audience can probably answer this better than I can, but we have a daily incident report, and drivers do report in failures. Also, every week, about 170 patrol gangers walk all the track on a Monday and look out for failures and track issues, but also cutting embankments. They have a report form to fill out if there's any failures. It'd be common enough that they would, when they see a failure, they tell their boss, they ring up the divisional offices and we'd head out and check them. We have SAP for reporting the faults, but and we need to get better at reporting the faults, but the plan would be then to be able to calibrate the model based on more failures once we get more records. But yeah, the drivers do report and stuff. They are separate to how the infrastructure is managed, so it's difficult, but this risk model will be available to everyone in Irish Rail, so you won't have to have software on your computer. It's going to be network-based.
Mm-hmm.
So we are hoping to get as many people as possible actually using the software and seeing the results.
Okay, great. So, yeah, great. Don't want to listen to me.
Well, first of all, congratulations. You are facing a daunting task, I'll say, because it's a massive network. And again, I mean, a bit of a Fergus line in terms of actually data collection. I mean, what I know from this type of risk models is that the more accurate your information is, obviously, the more accurate your output will be. And these days, with technologies like drones and others, would you actually see drones in? Because actually, if they use the right way, I don't know, it's actually at the moment state of the art. You see drones playing a role in actually getting better information faster, in terms of actually as a information tool to collect better data, than actually drivers or others, like getting something. I know at the moment it's actually not implemented, but something it could be a tool. Because if I see drones applied in any field at a very fast pace, will be something like this, for example.
We are looking into that. We've actually recently acquired a drone, and we hope to go out and use it at some of our bigger assets. So major bridges and cutting environments would be particularly suitable for drones because there's exactly. access issues.
That's exactly what I meant, yeah.
So we have a drone, we're getting trained up in using it, and we also do contract drone operators in sometimes for surveys. We've used it for flooding as well where there's access problems. But cutting environments are perfect for it to get the adjacent lands. A lot of our issues are actually starting from there. We just needed a starting point because with 3,700 assets, we needed to kind of move away from 1, 2, 3, 4 and have an overall global priority list to deal with. So next year mightn't even be that we're doing remediation works at these assets. It might be further data collection before we invest. So hopefully we would actually get out and do more detailed surveys of these sites and then make better decisions on how to invest. So yeah, drones are perfect. But they'll cover, 300 meters. Like, yeah, it's the scale of the network. So yeah,
but to add to it, drones in general for remediation work in particular mm-hmm. can be critical. We've used them a number of times, not necessarily in the rail network, but on projects where you have failures, you want to get rapid access, and you want to start designing something, but you don't have time, you don't have your traditional design window, but you can commission a drone survey overnight. You can get in, you can get good information, and you can start designing way ahead of where you'd be if you were looking for physical access.
I mean, drone technology is in its baby days at the moment, so what you can attach it to a drone a lot of things, not only a camera. So in the future, you can actually carry out very quick surveys or very regular surveys and collect far more accurate information. So it's something that, in my opinion, is actually at very early stages, and in particular in a linear network that you actually own the land under, you can actually carry out drones as you can carry inspections, probably with actually smaller closures, because the drone is much faster in collecting information if it's actually done, and far more systematic, you know what I mean?
Faster at collecting information, processing is a different issue. So.
But that's like the same way you've developed, the same way you've developed a tool to process a massive database. Again, there's a technology at the moment in trying to process that information in certain ways, so. I'm sure there's something you're looking at the moment.
There's also satellite data, which is probably, again, it's a little bit further down the track. But for large-scale infrastructure systems, potentially it's a very easy way of getting a lot of data very quickly.
Okay.
Great. Has anybody else got a question up there? Yep. Sorry.
So Valerie Scott, Irish Rail. So I'm wondering about, so with Network Rail, they treat drainage assets as separate assets. So like you did in 2011, they went out, identified all their drainage assets and set up the cyclical inspections. So in terms of the failures that are caused by, or that, like based on the information you've gathered and what you've done in developing this tool, would you think that moving forward, like creating drainage assets and setting them up as separate entities as opposed to part of the cutting or the embankment, do you think moving forward would it be beneficial?
It would definitely be beneficial. We at least have a starting point now. As part of this project, we restructured our asset register on SAP. So while we used to have it on the inspection cards and sketches, now it's a technical characteristic that's searchable. So you can see if there is a pipe, like an engineered drain, or if there's a ditch, if there's separate, it's all like filterable on SAP now. So we at least have a lot of information available at what drainage is installed at the crest, on the slope, and at the toe. So even in just the last year, we now have information of what lengths of ditches we're dealing with and what lengths of pipes. So that's a starting point, but ideally we should have drainage assets, individual assets we manage,
but I don't know if Network Rail gets around the issue of if we own the drainage or if an adjacent landowner owns the drainage, because both are important. So if there's issues with that.
Great. Maybe one more question, if there was one. Yep, great.
Declan Gibbons, Gibbons and Associates, is just one question. It's to do with vegetation. Is the vegetation helping you, keeping things together, or is it tearing it apart? My rockfall was definitively the roots grow and it pushed the rock off.
So for our soil assets, it's helpful to a certain degree. Grass is good, shrubs, yeah. But then briars can cover the surface, but they don't have a root system that actually secures the network. We also, we're getting better at recording the different types of vegetation, so our environmental executive has issued us with ways of identifying the different types of vegetation. So winter heliotrope is an invasive species that has a shallow root network. So while it covers the slope, it doesn't actually secure the slope. So we're getting better at identifying them. Like other invasive species, Japanese knotweed die back in the winter, so it doesn't actually help us as much as other vegetation. So your best vegetation would be grass or shrubs. But at rock slopes, we rather not have vegetation cover, and it makes it easier to inspect them as well. So they're all characteristics on SAP, and they're taken into account in the model.
Yeah, so in general, it's also the vegetation and the
density
are taken into account, and it's linked a little bit to the slope drainage. So if you think about the failure mechanisms where we're trying to keep the rainwater from infiltrating the slope, and we're trying to maintain the negative pore pressures, then in general on a soil acid, the root systems are helpful because it helps keep the soil from getting saturated in that kind of shallow 1 meter band. But on rock slopes, it's a hindrance.
Okay, unless someone's got a burning question, I think I'll just wrap it up. Just a few things before I let you go. We did record this session, the whole afternoon, so it goes up on a thing called Engineers TV. If you haven't been on Engineers Ireland website and you're really bored one Wednesday night, you can watch this again, or a multitude of other stuff that's on there. But I think it is good. All this stuff is saved there, so if you have colleagues who couldn't make it today, you're able to watch it back, and there are interesting talks there. And just, I said at the beginning, this is worth 4 hours of CPD. It's kind of self-assessed CPD, but it is coming. I think Engineers Ireland in 2017 are going to make a condition of chartership that you have your 40 hours. So, and obviously, if you're going for chart, is it 35? Okay, sorry. But still a lot. But also, if you're going for chartership, they do look for evidence that you've come to be keeping up your CPD. So events like this feed into that and structured reading. So just remind you about that. We had sign-in sheets at the entrance. So if you didn't sign that, it'd be great if you could sign it just on the way out. I ask you, I suppose, in terms of structures and construction, if there's any skills gaps that you think in your work are missing or not available, we'd be very keen to put together, to maybe put courses together or events that might fill those gaps, and things that I'd be thinking of at the moment. There's probably a lot of people returning to Ireland who aren't familiar with the Eurocodes, maybe from abroad, so it might be practical examples of using the Eurocodes, or it could be something as diverse as robustness or foundations or dynamics or something like that. But if there's something that you think that engineers Ireland could help with, I'd be keen to hear from you, and we might be able to put something together if there was enough interest in it. Apart from that, I think we had three great lectures today. We covered a lot of ground, from landmark structures and first of a kinds to legacy bridges in Ireland and everything in between. And I suppose one of the things is that, like, when you're designing and constructing new builds, it isn't just for now, it's for the 120 or the 200 or 300 years time. So it's to try and just think about that when you are designing, that they're cheap to maintain and will stand the test of time. And I'd just like to thank Marcus and Aidan and Catherine and Paul for all the time and effort they've put in to be with us here today. It takes a lot of effort to put these presentations together, so it's really appreciated, and I just ask the audience to show their appreciation in the usual manner.